And now, to entertain you tonight with a gala discussion and a recording session, Matt and Greg and the fabulous Beach Boys talk.
Welcome, everybody.
Hello, hello.
Welcome, 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 everyone, back to another episode of Beach Boys Talk. This is a live stream show dedicated to our favorite band, the Beach Boys. I'm Greg. This is my brother, Matt, and we are lifelong Beach Boy fans. We just love them so much. Now, this is not a podcast. It's not a radio show. This is a live stream show, meaning it's happening live right now. And the best part about it, Matt, is we get to chat live with our friends from all over the world right over here. You can see it, right? It says the chat experts. And welcome to all of our wonderful friends. We're so happy you're here.
Yes, and we always like to say we're not experts, musicologists. We're just big fans of the band, two brothers who love it. Yeah, and speaking experts. Of loving the Beach Boys, what a great show we have tonight. We're going to talk a little Many Moods of Matt, where I give my opinions on a Beach Boy-related topic. We're going to talk about our question of the week, which was, what is your favorite band or artist other than the Beach Boys? And we had some interesting answers in that, so I'm looking forward to talking about that, as well as share ours. And then Greg and I are always honored when this guy comes on our show, our friend. He had a lot to do with this album right here, the Beach Boys concert. You can hear him announcing on it. And it was actually his idea for the record. Hopefully he'll tell that story tonight. But our guest, special guest tonight, is the legendary Fred Vail. So I'm so excited to have him. So I hope... Thank you, everybody that's here with us tonight. Yeah. Stick around and join us. And then Greg will do some requests as well at the end of the show. Yep.
Yeah, and we're thinking tonight maybe we do some requests from some of the bands that we saw on the Facebook poll. So I know I saw like the Birds on there and the Eagles and a lot of other bands beside the Beach Boys. So pretty cool stuff.
Yeah. So really different kind of tastes out there. You know, when I think about the Beach Boys, I have very limited you know, time to listen to other bands if I'm going to listen. There's a few, but some of the answers out there, I was really surprised. So I can't wait to hear some of the reasoning too, you know, but it's all matter of taste, I suppose, right? So anyways.
Yeah, and as we've done this season, at the beginning of every show, we'll sing a little bit of Billy's song that he sang at the beginning of his show, Billy Hinchey's tune. It's our little tribute to him. I'm sure he's here with us hanging out, doing his show, probably telling a few pretty good jokes. So we'll do a little bit. This is for Billy. How about some hearts in the chat? You can put some hearts in the chat for Billy as we remember him.
Rest in peace, Billy.
Hello, my friends. It's good to see you again. You know it's been a few years since you went away. Now I'm happy to say I'm doing okay myself. I can dig what's happening. And every day there is something new. And hey, good things are coming my way. Tell me how you've been. There's so much you've gotta tell me. Talk about them good old days. We laugh and say, hey, hey, Manny, you're okay. Let's take it nice and easy now. It's back in the groove. Let's stick around for a little while and hey, good things are coming my way. Thank you. way back to you, babe, with a burning love inside.
It's for Billy with some four C's on the end of that. Yeah. Oh, man. Good stuff. Welcome, welcome, welcome to all of our friends. We're so happy you're here. We got a full chat tonight. If you're new to the show, this is your first time joining us, maybe tell us your name, tell us where you're from, maybe give us your favorite Beach Boys album. Here's a Billy joke. Why was the female lion crying? She found out her boyfriend was a cheetah. Oh, that was good.
Greg, you're like a mushroom. You're a fun guy.
Oh, boy. That was good.
A fun guy.
Yeah, that was good. I like it. Very nice. Very nice. All right, what else we got to do here? Matt, we got a couple. Before we do the many moods, I have a couple surprises for you, my friend. One I'll do now and one I'll do later. We have a pretty – so if y'all know Monza Media. He joins us on the show every once in a while when he can, but he's a
– He's here tonight, yep.
He's a fantastic artist, and he's got an awesome Instagram following. We actually – we kind of work together on this, and Matt, I wanted to surprise you. So you have to look – you'll have to look at the screen.
Okay.
Like, you won't be able to see it on the Zoom, so you'll have to look at the actual screen as it comes up. But Monza – did a really cool thing for us here, and I don't know if you can see it, but I am just absolutely thrilled. I think it's amazing. It's just super cool. I'm interested to hear what you think about it. Can you see it yet?
I do not yet. While we're waiting, though, Christopher Lopez from Puerto Rico is here tonight.
Whoa. Hey, Christopher.
I do see it now.
Pretty awesome, right?
That is awesome.
Yeah, Monza. Everybody, this was a commission done by Monza, Zach Monza. Just awesome, awesome, cool picture there. So I wanted to show
really
that to you.
Really talented guy. That is really cool.
He is really, really talented guy.
And in fact, Monza, thank you.
Yeah, Monza did like individual pictures of each of the Beach Boys from around kind of that Sunflower era. It's kind of late 60s, 70, early. And they're fantastic. And I saw him do those. I'm like, oh, man, I just think it's so cool. So, Monza, man, thank you so much for all your hard work on that. It is incredible, and we'll make sure we share that around.
Wow,
when we get a chance. So
that's probably the coolest thing I've ever seen. I'm not even kidding.
Oh, it's awesome.
Really cool.
Yeah, no, it's really cool. I was excited to see that. So, Matt, let's get into the show here.
All right.
Let's get into my favorite segment, which is the many moods of Matt.
The many moods of
So I got invited by some of my my day job friends to do some karaoke the end of this week. And a lot of them know I like the Beach Boys. And they said, you got to find a Beach Boys song to sing. And it got me thinking, wow, that's a task, right? Because most Beach Boys songs are based on their four-part harmony, their five-part harmony. There's not a lot of songs you could just get up there and belt by the Beach Boys. So I may have to pass on that and sing something else if I sing at all. But anyway, that's besides the point. What that got me thinking about was the fact that the Beach Boys are very unique. There's a handful of bands that can do what they did well. And that is just make the vocals, the harmony sound, all of that be kind of their front man, their lead, you know. In the early 60s, Mike Love did sing a lot of leads, but he also shared those leads with Brian. He was out front in the stage, but as it went later on, even on the records, you hear three, four different guys singing lead songs. But what's known, the signature sound of the Beach Boys is that harmony, that four-part harmony, that five-part harmony. When you think of Mick Jagger, you think of the Rolling Stones. When you think of Frankie Valli, you think about the Four Seasons. You know, Freddie Mercury, you think of Queen. But when you think of the Beach Boys, it's not just one guy. Maybe in the past 10 years, people might say Brian Wilson, but Brian Wilson was not the front man. He was the kind of the architect of the music. So tonight it's not a question as much as an observation, and maybe you all agree or disagree, but I think the fact that the Beach Boys were able to stay on the charts for so long and have so many hit records and albums without really, a front man, so to speak. So the casual fan, when you hear their song on the radio, if it's early Beach Boys, you can tell it's them. But if it's later, it's harder to tell. And I think it's a testament to the Beach Boys that as a collective whole, they need, you know, you needed everybody in that band to get that sound. And I'm not so sure that's true with a lot of rock bands. If you take away their front man, they're totally different. But with the Beach Boys, they needed everybody. And maybe I'm off base here, but maybe I'm off base in saying I don't think the Beach Boys had a front man, had a consistent front man. But I just think it's a testament to them more about how their pop music there is a little bit higher, you know, higher art form than some of them. So thank you to the Beach Boys for that. And I'm going to have to try something else at karaoke, I suppose. But that's it.
The many moons
Yeah, it's interesting to think about because you had mentioned it before, but when you say Mick Jagger, it's basically like saying Rolling Stones, right? They're kind of synonymous.
Right.
When you say Robert Plant, Led Zeppelin, when you say Freddie Mercury, when you say Kurt Cobain, David
Nirvana,
Lee Roth,
right?
David Lee Roth. You might as well just say Van Halen. But if I say Bruce Johnston, I don't know that anybody in the world probably knows besides our circle who that actually is. And I'm maybe not giving Bruce enough name recognition credit.
No,
there,
but I think that might even be true about an Al Jardine or even Carl Wilson. If it's not somebody that's that learned on music, but just listens to the radio, if you say Carl Wilson and the, you know, they may not know. And I think it's just all five of the guys in that band were important to that sound. And that's why I say they were kind of all front men, like their collective efforts, you know.
I get it. I might disagree. I think it worked out for them.
Yeah.
Definitely. But I don't know that it was by design. I mean, I feel like they had a different leader every 2 years. You know what I mean?
They did.
A different direction every 2 years. And I don't know that that was a good thing or it was planned. You
well,
know?
I think it made it difficult sometimes, like I said, just for the radio recognition in the early 60s when you have fun, and I Get Around. Little Deuce Scoop, you know, where you have the Brian on top, Mike singing lead. That was the formula, so to speak. Maybe I shouldn't use that word, but it was the sound everybody recognized. But then when you get into even Pet Sounds or Smiley Smile, Wild Honey, it all starts to change. And I think when they're on the radio, even if they sing the same style of song, you weren't sure if it was the Beach Boys or maybe even like an imitator Beach Boys, you know, because Denise, they just changed, you know.
Denise says, it's karaoke. Don't overthink it. Just something fun that the crowd can join in on. And I think that's kind of the interesting thing is.
It's hard with the Beach Boys.
Like
to do
what,
that.
If you're singing Good Vibrations, what part do you sing? Like what part comes up on the screen when you're doing karaoke?
I'm picking up. Yeah. What about the good vibrations part?
Or the high part, which is like with the Beach Boys, there's so many, like they're all iconic parts, you know, with the good
exactly
like that. And that part is
up good.
So who like who does what on a karaoke? So like somebody mentioned up earlier that you should do Unbugged at My Old Man. That'd be hilarious.
Even California Girls, which I think is one of Mike's best
help me Rhonda,
and it's a great one. California Girls, when you get to the chorus though, what do? I wish that you know, you sing high. I mean, maybe, but might work. But
it's really interesting, right? Because you're good up until this part. California girl. Then what are you singing?
And then if you don't sing there, it just sounds kind of weird, you know?
Yeah, it's exactly. That's the majority of their song. Somebody mentioned Help Me Rhonda. I think that was one you can sing.
That's a closer one.
What Beach Boys song can you sing at karaoke all the way through without having to decide, crap, which vocal part am I going to take here?
Yeah, and I appreciate the suggestions. I'll look into them, but the point of that more is that just how complex their vocals are that you can't just pick it up at a karaoke and sing it. You know, you have key changes and you have those harmonies. So,
Taylor said it's hard to do four or five parts. Eddie, it's hard to do Beach Boys stuff, honestly, by yourself. Dennis. I usually do Surfing USA. That's a pretty good one. Although I don't know, do we count that as a Beach Boys song? I guess we do.
Well, it is, but
Abby says I'll solve the mystery for Matt. He should pick a mid-60s Beach Boys song and sing Brian's high part. Okay, but that's the problem. There's a bunch of other parts going on. And what about Mike's parts, like Kiss Me Baby?
Yeah. Like, yeah, Mike, exactly.
You, like, well,
even,
me, baby.
Even I Get Around, one of their biggest hits, you can't sing all the way through.
So my, but wait. My folks, I would be all right. Then you pause.
Pause. Yeah, I know. It was so heavy. Yeah, I know.
Karaoke, you actually get to pick whose line you're singing, so it actually just says pause. Wait.
Oh, you know, I thought about Anthony Said Darlin'. I thought about that one. That one's pretty close. You probably do Darlin'.
Ooh, Darlin'. Darlin', Darlin's like, a good
one. Wild Honey has a few more tunes like that where you could sing them straight up, I think. But
Do You Want to Dance might not be a bad one. Good call, Buzz. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah, it's true.
What else? Oh, It's Okay.
Oh, yeah. Except the gotta go to it part would be weird, you know. You go,
well, that,
yeah.
Well, that's like an oh yeah. Well, and that's another thing too. It's like the main line is usually Brian's high part, and like doing that at karaoke is a little rough.
Yeah,
you know. All of a sudden,
I think Joyce in my room would be hard because you can't stack the harmonies like they do in the song, right?
There's
I'd have to sing the same thing. I guess you could go up, right?
You said that, Joyce. I think Joyce is right. I think In My Room could do it. You just keep, you kind of step up.
In My Room.
Like,
I guess so.
Sloop John B. Carol, Sloop John B might work, but that's like a classic duo. That's like Islands in the Stream. You know, you kind of need, you kind of need.
And also,
you
have that a cappella part in the middle. That would be hard. You know?
Yeah.
Home, let me go.
Steven, I'm glad you brought up Surfer Girl, because to me, Surfer Girl is one of my favorite Beach Boys songs, but I very rarely do it. At all, because it's so lush with harmonies that
it needs,
I don't
everything.
Know, it doesn't super translate, you know. Like, already I'm like, oh man, this is not super good. And that could just be
I saw a couple, Girl Don't Tell Me. That, now that's a straight up one. That's like the only Beach Boys song without any harmony in it.
That's
really
a good one. Sail on Sailor's a really good one. Shay brought, is that Shay? Hi, Shay. Hi, Joe. Hey, Joe.
Sail on Sailor, yeah.
Joe from here, Wishing You Were Here. Joe Rice is a celebrity here. In
I said, you know, yeah, but Les says Barbara Ann, maybe, but then you got a bop, Harley, bop, 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 bop.
Harley, Harley said Fall Breaks Back into Winter. Do that one.
Yikes.
Freak some people out. You'll lose a lot of friends at your day job.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I'll get drug tested or something if I sing that.
That'd be pretty funny.
But anyway, I just think the Beach Boys are unique that way, that they don't have like a typical karaoke song you can pull up, you know, like Sweet Caroline or something, you know, or a Billy Joel song or whatever you hear, Journey, you know, just a city boy. You know, the Beach Boys don't have that because all the voices are so important to the mix. And they're not the only band by any means that's like that. I think of Chicago as another band that is, you know, important as a collective whole, and the Eagles as well. But I do think the Beach Boys do it the best. You know, I think that's what makes them the best ever.
Let's look at some of our, so let's see if we can see this. Let's try and
We're going to go into our poll, right? Or our question.
Yes, sir, we are.
And the question for the week was, what is some of your favorite bands or artists? I think I said, what is your favorite band or artist other than the Beach Boys? But some people wrote more than one. That's okay. Can I tell mine before we go to the chat?
Yeah, we got it. Yes. We want to go through our Facebook poll, but yes, what are yours, Matt?
Yeah, that is a poll, though. That's
you just
mean,
pick
yeah.
one. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I want to pick a band and an artist. The band is the Four Seasons, Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. They are the East Coast equivalent of the Beach Boys to me. Again, the harmonies. Now, they did have Frankie Valli, to be fair. That's a little bit, you know, you have that. Talk about a front man, right? And a guy who. And then my favorite artist, if I didn't have just a band, but as a solo unit, would be Billy Joel. I just think his stuff is brilliant. So those are
interesting.
Two.
I like that you split it up into group and then like a solo. So for those of you watching at home right now, we did a Facebook poll. What are your favorite bands or artists besides the Beach Boys? And so we went through. And we've got some good stuff here. Looks like David Hesp says Neil Young.
Neil Young.
Oh, man, take a look at my life. I'm a lot like you. That's good stuff. Neil Young. Russ and Tracy say The Birds. Oh, that's good.
Birds.
Do everything.
Turn. Hey, Mr. Good. Tambourine Man, right?
Yeah. Owen Hassel says James Taylor.
In my mind, I'm going to Carolina.
That's good. James
Fire
Taylor's
and
good
rain.
Stuff.
Yeah.
Joey Hooper says the left bank. Joey, you're going to have to help me out with that one. I don't know the left bank. I have to listen to that. So I need to make a list of these ones that I don't know. Isaiah says Steely Dan. Steely Dan.
You know, I like the album Asia is awesome by Steely Dan. If you haven't heard that album, it's AJA. And then they have their My Old School, you know, is a good one too. Yeah, I like
We heard you're leaving. That's okay.
They have a Do It Again too, a different version of Do It Again.
They do have a different version. Love it, Steely Dan. Ed Cochran, Nick Femin says Madness. Matt, you say mine is the Four Seasons. Okay, this is a cool picture from Matt Lewis here. It's got Frankie in the picture there.
Yeah, that is cool.
Joe,
wish I could meet him.
Joe
awesome.
Says the Beatles.
Ooh, I need your love, babe. No, it's true.
Nice. The Kaiser Chiefs.
I saw her standing there. I like that one.
Do you know who the Kaiser Chiefs are, Matt?
I have no idea. That's why this was an interesting question to do, because a lot of these bands I've never heard of before at all. So I got to check them out, you know.
Justin Patton says Kraftwerk or Prince. Love Prince. Good stuff.
Prince,
there.
Yeah.
Buzz Ulrich, is there an option? Just kidding. REO Speedwagon. Nice. Awesome.
Heard it from a friend who. Heard it from a friend who. Heard it from another. You've been messing around.
That's a good one. I love it. Oh, Fleetwood Mac. Dude, Matt, that might be mine besides the four. I love Fleetwood
Mac. You ever hear him sing Farmer's Daughter?
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
Yeah, they did an awesome cover of Farmer's Daughter live. Really, really neat stuff.
Yeah. Pretty chill,
let's see.
Yep.
Chris says Bruce Springsteen. That's pretty pretty good.
Yep.
I'm trying to think of some Bruce Springsteen.
Dancing out on my friend, kid and wife from old jet. I went out for a ride, but I never went back.
Oh, that's like Get You Back. It's the same chord.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
Chicago.
Susan Harris said Beck. Dennis
nice.
Said Chicago. Oh, Electric Light Orchestra. Yeah.
ELO.
I like them. Yeah, I listen to a lot of ELO. We had our long road trip, and I picked some ELO to listen to.
Nice. Crosby, Stills, Nash, love CSNY. That's good stuff,
yeah.
Too. Chicago, America, Paul.
Moody Blues, I see on there.
Ooh, I like Yes. They did.
Owner of the Lonely Heart.
I love that song. Is that Yes?
I don't know who sings that, but Marianne says the Four Seasons, Neil Sedaka. You know, I do love Neil Sedaka, man. Calendar Girl. I love the videos when he's dancing from the 50s. It's so awesome.
Don't
My heart's
take
in a world.
Oh,
yeah, he sings that
away from me.
Yeah, Neil Sedaka, that's good stuff. The Eagles, CCR from Sue.
Ooh, CCR, that's a good one.
Yeah, CCR is great stuff. Susan Hour, another Steely Dan, Stevie Wonder. Love Stevie Wonder. Joel says Carole King. One of the best writers of all songwriters of all time. Love it. Yeah. David says The Beatles. Joanne Figueroa says The Beatles. Hi, Joanne. Hope you're doing well. Good stuff. The Beatles. Volbeat, the Beatles, more Beatles, the Doobie Brothers, the Bee Gees. I don't know.
Doobies
the Bee Gees
pre Michael McDonald or after? That'd be interesting. Yeah, I didn't see a lot of Bee Gees on there. You know,
some Phil Collins there from Anna. Love
Phil
it.
Collins.
Love it. Los Lobos, Elvis Costello. Matt, do you like Elvis Costello?
I don't know a lot of Elvis Costello. I know he really respects Brian Wilson's music and stuff, but I don't know much about him. I know that song Veronica from like the 90s. You know that one?
Yeah. Joe Winter says Foreigner. I love Foreigner.
Oh, so Huey Lewis in the News. I like Huey Lewis in the News.
You're as cold as ice.
Man, 80s is awesome. We should, Matt, do an 80s show. Can we do 80s talk?
That would be fun, yeah.
80s talk would be good. I don't know a lot about the Beach Boys, but
I'd have a lot to learn. Oh, Joel said The Who. I've never gotten into The Who. That's interesting.
Oh, I love The Who.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I need to listen to them more. I don't know much about them, but.
Love The Who. Yeah. Yeah. Who's good stuff? The Turtles.
I like The Turtles.
Me too.
Eleanor? Yeah.
Yeah. Who's the guy? Who's the guy in the Turtles that's always got the tambourine, the little fat guy?
Yeah, and you know, I forget his name. It's Mark something. Maybe
He's
in the
great.
Chat somebody can tell us, but he was in that picture at the airport when Brian Wilson came back from Michigan.
No, that's not
yeah.
him. No.
Yeah. Yes, it is. Nuh-uh. It's a dude from the Turtles.
No, it's
I bet
not.
You. I bet you $100.
You bet me $100.
Yes. In the chat, tell me the guy.
No. Hold on. No. Nobody answer. I'm not going to read the chat. Let's do a bet on this. Let's bet something that we can do on the air.
Saying that guy in the picture is from the Turtles. He's from that area. And it was in that documentary.
Okay. How about the loser has to take
Laurel Canyon?
How about the loser? I'm not going to look at the chat. The loser has to take a pie in the face on air.
All right.
Okay. Do you agree? Handshake. Air handshake.
All right, okay. So we need an expert to tell us.
You are wrong. It looks like him, but it's not.
No, he's there.
No, he's not.
Mark Volman, that's his name. Now, was Mark Volman in that picture?
That's not the question. The question.
I know. The question is, was he in the picture?
In that picture where they're at the airport. And
Anthony says, yes, it is.
Well, who are we going to trust? Who are we going to trust for the answer on this one? No, we know he was in the Turtles, but was he in that picture?
No, I know. That's the question. Was he in that picture at the at LAX, Brian Wilson, with all his folks before he kind of left him?
I'm telling you, it's a guy that looks like him, but it's not him.
Our experts are saying that they're in the picture. So I guess we'd have to Google it, right?
Okay. Let me Google it real quick.
Well, anyway, the point is the Turtles song Eleanor is awesome. And happy together. Harley Pinson says, Mark Volman, yes, he's in the picture. Anthony says he is there. So that's three now.
Hey, if I'm going to take a pie in the face, I want to make sure it's 100% accurate.
Steve says he is in that picture. So Steve. And then See the Wave said Tommy James and the Shondells. Oh, yeah.
Dang it. I just typed in. I typed in Brian Wilson Airport picture, Mark Volman, and
Chet Walker says he is. Yeah, I told you.
That picture comes up.
All right. Greg gets a pie in the face, everybody. I look forward to that.
Why is he in this picture? Why is he there?
Because he hung out with it. He's from that. You ever see that Echo in the Canyon? It's all in there, too. He was part of that group.
Dude, I've watched that movie like a million times, but I didn't.
Yeah,
I didn't know he was there.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Anyway, he was. So, yeah. And that's an iconic picture, too. It's pretty cool.
Well, there's a bunch of different ones. It's the one where they're in a line, kind of?
Yeah, he's in that one, yeah. So.
Is that Graham Nash in this picture, too?
They go by Flo and Eddie. I don't think Graham Nash is in there, but they go by Flo and Eddie. Oh, Joe Winter said, no one has mentioned the Doors, Jim Morrison. Yeah. I like some of the Doors, but that's the same thing for me where Jim Morrison just sings all the songs. So if you don't like his voice that much, they're hard to listen to. They don't have like harmonies and things, you know. That's why I appreciate bands that are not just with a front man, you know.
Riders on the storm. Is this fever bonding?
That's true, Steve. The first bet I gave was a $100 bet, not a pie in the face. But
yeah, because I'm not giving you $100. I wasn't that sure, but yeah, no, I was pretty sure, though. All right, well, we'll have to figure out when I take a pie in the face.
Oh, that guy from Procol Harum died today. And they got that awesome song. Do you know who I'm talking about? What's his name in the chat?
Hey, Fred's calling me real quick. I'm going to
Fred's
this, okay?
In. All right.
No, he's calling me on the phone. So let me.
Oh, okay. All right. There was a song I listened to today. Was it called, what's it called? Shadow of White or something like that. Love that song a lot. So rest in peace. If you can remember his name in the chat, I don't remember. I think the last name was Brooker. I think so. Eddie Money. You know, Joyce, I was just watching a King of Queens last night, and Doug and his friend there got a bunch of money. They wanted a bet, and they have to spend it. So they find Eddie Money at a restaurant. He comes to their house, and he sings. It's pretty funny. I don't know if you watched that show, but it was funny. So Bay City Rollers. Don't they sing S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y? Isn't that Bay City Rollers? Oh, Gary Brooker. That's him. Yep. Whiter shade of pale. Okay, I was totally wrong with the name, but yeah, that's exactly right. Thank you, Patricia. Gary Brook, Whiter Shade of Pale. If I'm sure you all have heard that song, but if you haven't, crank it up. It's awesome. Helen Crane, Jan and Dean. I love some Jan and Dean. One of my favorite Jan and Dean songs is The New Girl in School. I love that one. And you know, Brian Wilson wrote that, of course, but I like the production. I like the sound of the music in there. Linda, that's a good one too. and then a Honolulu Lulu. So I like, I don't know a lot of Jan and Dean, but I know some of their, I have their record vinyl of their greatest hits, you know, that came out in the 60s, and all the songs on there are pretty good. Little Old Lady from Pasadena, things like that. Yes. Whiter Shade of Pale. Yep. Check that one out if you haven't heard it. So we continue to talk about our favorite bands other than the Beach Boys. Any love for the Four Seasons in the chat? I got to tell you, their early stuff is so good, but their late 60s, mid 60s, late 60s stuff is really good. If you can listen to some of that, there's one song they have called Something's on Her Mind, is really good. What's the other one called? And That Reminds Me, it's a Nat King Cole remake that they do. It's really good. Love it. I see Cheap Trick in there. The Police, Sting. Yeah. Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic. I like that song. Every little thing she does. Allison, I don't know who the Seekers are. I'm going to have to look them up. I know you like the Four Seasons as well. Tom Dale, yes. Sidewalk Surfing. Yep. Just like Catch a Wave, right? With different lyrics. I do like Honolulu Lulula, and Dead Man's Curve is pretty good too. Oh yeah. Okay. You saw that, Joyce. He was hilarious. Yeah. Allison, what's your favorite Four Seasons song? That's a tough one for me. There's so many that I love. Bye Bye Baby. Will You Love Me Tomorrow? Their cover. Yeah. The Jersey Boys movie is pretty good. All right.
Hey, Matt, we got Fred on. So everybody, Fred.
Let's do it.
Is,
all right.
Wait, hold on. You got a little excited there.
Oh, sorry. I was excited. Fred, I forgot about Dion.
Yeah. Hey, Fred, everybody, we're going to chat amongst ourselves for 1 minute while I'm going to send you a fresh link. Okay.
I got to log out and come back in.
Yeah. Yep. So everybody,
right now?
We will be right back with Fred Vail coming up
so
in
do
about
that right
one.
Now. Okay.
1 minute. Okay. Bye.
Okay.
Hello.
All right, everybody. Hello. Hey, thank you.
The Brothers Coffee.
We are here at your service, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience. It is our honor and privilege to once again, for the third time in the history of our show, to get to talk with history itself, an absolute legend.
The legend.
Beach Boys promoter, manager.
I love that. Oh, man. I love the Beach Boy poster behind you.
Oh, thanks.
Oh, is that cool?
Lulu and David and Jonathan, something or other. It's like,
yeah,
is that in English? That must be it.
It's a London Astoria, Finsbury Park. Yeah.
Yeah, Fred, well, that looks, it looks 60s for sure.
Yeah.
Fred, you're getting a lot of highs in the chat. Hi from Stacy Foran. I think you know Stacy. You know Joyce and Don and Denise.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And Helen, yeah, and Sandy and Russ and Tracy, Marianne, Claire, Macrina, Darren, Susan, Les, Steven, Joe, Clean Man, Frank Villa. Oh, by the way, our very good friend, Steven Kalinich, says he loves you.
Oh, he does, yes.
Well, I love Steve. He and I are old friends. And
oh, he's such a great
friend. So many memories in California.
Yeah, I bet you guys do. I bet you do.
He comes here occasionally to record. John Teven, good friend of his, they did a project here together. So yeah, we've been here several times, and we try to hook up every time.
Yeah,
awesome. But he's a terrific guy. Loves the Beach Boys, loves Dennis, you know, loves the whole clan, the whole family, so to speak. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were just talking with our chat about favorite bands besides the Beach Boys. Do you have any favorites that you're allowed to say out loud? We know your Beach Boys are your number one, right? But
For sure. There's no question. I mean, growing up, you know, I liked a lot of the bands. Like the Crickets, it would start with the Crickets, I guess.
Yeah.
And then it would go to the Four Seasons, who were basically the East Coast Beach Boys.
Yeah.
Bob Crew. And Bob Crew was a great producer doing stuff on the East Coast. And of course I ended up booking the Seasons, which we're going to talk about during this program.
Yes.
Awesome.
You know, I mean, there's so many. I mean, the Ventures, I ended up booking the Ventures. They were a great band. Awesome. They were a guitar band. They weren't a vocal band.
Right.
They were a great, great band. Trying to think who else. The first act that I booked was one of the first acts that I booked. If people know my bio, when I was in high school, I ran for this office called Commissioner of Entertainment, and I'd lost it once, and it was my senior year, so I only had one more crack at it. I was running against the incumbent, a girl named Georgianne Coffey, and there were four other girls. Georgianne was the incumbent. There were four other girls and me running. And so I, you know, said that if you elect me your Commissioner of Entertainment, I'll bring name entertainment to the school for our assemblies, you know, like artists, recording artists, which had never been done before. And I won in a runoff with Tylee Jones, who was one of the other girls that ran against me. So obviously, unlike politicians of today that never fulfill their, you know, their promises to their electorate, I came through and I brought in the Diamonds, which were a great 50s, 60s group, the Stroll, Little Darlin'. One summer night, I brought in Jan and Dean, actually.
Oh, wow.
This was in May of 1962, my senior year.
Wow.
Johnny Crawford, who was on the long-running TV show, The Rifleman, with Chuck Connors, brought him in. And the Coup de Grace in May, I brought in Smokey Robinson and the Miracles. And
to your high school.
Yeah, to
it's
my
amazing.
High school. For free shows, you know. Of course, to go to shows back then, it was only a buck and a half anyway, $2 maybe. But that's what got me started on the booking thing. I mean, I was already in radio. I'd worked as a gopher at three Sacramento top 40 stations. Well, actually, two top 40s and an easy listening. The top 40, one was KRAK, which I started when I was 12. The second was KROY or KXOA. KROY, KCRA. So actually four stations, three top 40s and an MOR AC station.
Yeah.
And I worked as a gopher for 3 years, just, you know, every chance I could get, summer vacation, spring, Christmas break, Easter break, every weekend, Saturday, you know, go down there for 3 or 4 hours and take dedications and all that sort of stuff. So finally, my sophomore year, there was a jazz station looking for a weekend relief jock. And I got a job at that station that was 15. And then 2 years later, when I was 17, a station where I'd been a gopher, KXOA Radio AM and FM, it was simulcast on both the bands. And they split their FM off and became a country station, KCNW, for K Country and Western. And they were looking for a staff. And I knew more about country than anybody at the radio station, because it was a top 40 station. So the guy said, well, you bring in your record collection and you contact all the labels to get us promo copies, and we'll make you the midday guy and the program director, which, you know, back then the program director was like the music director.
Right.
He didn't hire or fire. The guy that did the hiring and the firing and made the air checks was the operations manager. And that was Jack Lawson. And that's the guy that hired me at 17 to be midday jock and PD. So I started, you know, doing a regular show, but I was making $1.50 an hour, actually $1.52 an hour.
Hey-o.
And, you know, so it wasn't a whole lot of money. So I needed to supplement my income. So I started booking artists. And then the first two artists that I actually booked for an outside event were Jerry Wallace, a great artist in the 50s, mostly known for a hit song called Primrose Lane. Mm-hmm. And he also did Shutters and Boards, which was written by the World War II combat hero Audie Murphy.
Oh,
and,
crazy. Okay,
cool. And then he did another song. Let's see, How the Time Flies. That was a moderate hit. Mm-hmm. And what else? Who else did I bring in? Oh, I brought in Bobby Freeman of Do You Want to Dance?
Do You Want to Dance? Yeah.
Cover, yeah. You know, later. And they've covered in what, 63 or maybe 64. And then he did another big dance hit called The Swim. Mm-hmm. And he just passed away. He went to my mother's college, San Francisco State. Uh-huh. And they both went there. He went there after my mother did, but they went to the same school in San Francisco. And he was quite a guy. I mean, he just passed in the last, I don't know, 5 years, maybe. Mm-hmm. I read about it. You know, he had passed. Another artist who I worked with, but I never booked him into my high school, was a guy named Jimmy Rogers. And he also passed away in the last 2 years.
Yeah.
And he was an incredible guy. And he was one of the first artists that I really got to know. Mm-hmm. I was really active in his fan club. His fan club director or president, a woman named Mary Stevens. And I would go down to LA with my parents on my dad's business trips. And I'd go out and I'd walk around Hollywood going into record labels. And, you know, and I ended up becoming friends with Mary Stevens, who was Jimmy Rogers' publicist and directed his fan club. And then she set me up an interview with him when he played in San Francisco at the Fairmont Hotel. So I went, it's funny because we went to the Fairmont, which is a plush hotel, one of the oldest in San Francisco on Nob Hill, world famous hotel. Mm-hmm. And he did a dinner show there. They had a beautiful, called a Venetian Room. It was a beautiful New York style supper club, a whole full orchestra, you know, big band, not a combo or rhythm section, but the whole works. And so we went and saw him, and it was plush. I mean, it was my mom and I had, we kept it to a minimum. I think I had a sandwich and she had a salad or something like that, because the prices, you know, were enormous for that.
Right.
And so we're waiting for the check so I can go backstage and see Jimmy after the show, which is what Mary had arranged. And it's not coming and it's not coming. And finally we get the attention of one of the waiters and he comes over, can I help you? And I said, yeah, we'd like to settle up. You know, I have an appointment to meet with Mr. Rogers backstage. And he said, oh, your bill has been taken care of. Mr. Rogers took care of it. Oh, wow. So it was kind of a standing joke. My mom and I said for years, we could have had steak and lobster. Instead, right. We had a sandwich and a salad. But, you know, it was cool. And he was a great guy. He had a number one Honeycomb, a huge record in the 50s. And, Ring-a-ling a Larry-o and To Come Carry and I'm Falling in Love Again. And he was a folk singer, too. So we did a lot. He did several folk albums, you know, in Waltzing Matilda and stuff like that. But he was a really, really nice guy. And I got to know him. I interviewed him from a high school paper. And, you know, he was one of the first superstar that I met was Ricky Nelson on the set of The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. And I was about 14 years old. I think it was in the eighth grade. Oh. And that was the first superstar that I actually met. And then Jimmy was close thereafter, and Pat Boone shortly after that. Mm-hmm. And then I started booking acts, and I got to know them because I was booking.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Fred, have you heard Brian Wilson's new cover of Honeycomb? It's on that Long Promised Road soundtrack. He does it with his new band. He loves that
song.
You have
to
check it out.
Actually, yeah. I must embarrass myself by admitting to you and my many friends out there that I have not seen Long Promised Road. In fact, I think one of you guys was going to send me a CD, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, we are now.
Yeah. I thought one of you had said that. But anyway, I haven't seen it.
I'll make a note.
And it's cool that he would do Honeycomb. I can't imagine him doing it, but that's
yeah,
cool.
It's on. You could find that on YouTube. Maybe I'll send it to you later. But it's pretty neat. He just
we'll send you a
couple
DVD.
Years ago, so.
You have a DVD player, Fred?
Yeah.
On its way. It's on its way. We'll make sure it gets there to you.
Hey, great. Fred, before we get into some of your stories with the other bands, for those on our chat that are new and maybe didn't see you the last time, could you talk a little bit about how this came about here? How you got to know the Beach Boys and this record that has your voice on it? That'd be awesome.
Well, I did. The first concert that I did was a fundraiser for my alma mater, El Camino High School, for their senior class to raise money for their all-night grad party. I had been a senior when they were juniors, so they were in the class behind me. And I booked Jerry Wallace and Bobby Freeman into my grad party. And the word got out that it was a smash and everybody loved it. And so the senior class comes to me around March of 63 and says, we would like you to book our all-night grad party. And I was at Sacramento State. I was concerts chairman there as a freshman. And as a matter of fact, during that freshman year at Sac State, I brought in Four Freshmen, which was the group that Brian looked up to. The High Lows and the Four Freshmen influenced Brian to develop the famous Beach Boy Harmony. Mm. So I booked the Four Freshmen, and then a year later, I'm booking the Beach Boys, right? So only appropriate. So they come to me and they said, well, we want you to book our grad party. So I said, well, what's your budget? How much money do I, have to deal with? And they said, $750. And I said, man, that's great. I can get a band. I can maybe get a duo and like Jan and Dean or, Paul and Paula or Dick and Dee Dee or whatever. And they said, oh no, Fred, we don't have $750 for entertainment. We've got $750 for the whole grad party. And I said, well, you can't do it. You've got to get a venue. You got to get catering. You got to get security. Right. You got to get door prizes. You can't do it. And they were just like, they were devastated. And then the old electric light goes off. And I said, but I have an idea. Well, what's that? Why don't we find a band, a group, and we'll put on a concert and we'll raise money by selling tickets. And they thought it was a great idea, but the school principal, Dr. Abbott, and the class advisors thought it was crazy that they're going to give this $750 to this kid that just graduated, less than a year before. And, they're going to hope that it comes through, And they finally, basically, the kids wanted me to do it. They believed in me because I had come through for them the year before with all these artists that I brought to the high school. And they said, okay, well, you can give Fred the money. But if you pick the wrong act and nobody shows up or you lose money, you won't have a grad party. You won't have enough time to recoup your money from your candy sales and your car washes and your newspaper drives, all that sort of stuff. And so I went around, just trying to think, well, who are we going to get? Well, the Twist, Chubby Checker and Joey D, and that was kind of giving way to surf music. And, there were a number of surfing bands, but most of them, almost all of them, were guitar bands. So we had the Astronauts, the Challengers, Merced Blue Notes, the Ventures.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think some of the other ones, Lively Ones, but they were all guitar bands. Even Dick Dale. I mean, they did a little bit of vocals, but it was primarily guitar music. And so I said, well, I went to Tower Records. That was another thing. My whole life, guys, have been nothing but timing and blessing. Sacramento was at the hub of the state capital, so the legislature, the Senate, the assembly were there. But there was this guy out in West Sacramento named Russ Solomon. And when he was a teenager, his parents had a drugstore downtown Sacramento. I never went there, but his parents had this drugstore. And there was a theater and a drugstore, and they were called Tower Theater and Tower Drugs. Mm-hmm. And Russ, his parents, his mom and dad, the pharmacist and his wife, gave him a little 10 by 10 foot area in Tower Drugs to set up a record department when he's a teenager, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And that grows into Tower Records,
right,
which becomes,
wow,
at that point, the number one record retailer in the entire world. His first store, Tower One on Watt Avenue, right near El Camino, a mile from my house, maybe a mile and a quarter. I could take my bike there before I could drive.
Mm-hmm.
His first store, Tower Number One, was at Watt Avenue. So I got to know Russ because in this first store, he was not only the owner, the founder, the manager, but he was a clerk. You know, so we got to know Russ. You know, I'd walk in and he'd say, Fred, we got, you know, a new surf album out. Challengers came out with a new album. You want to check it out on aisle four or whatever.
Man.
So I went and talked to Russ and Dick Harris. And there was another guy there, Carl Scott. And they were like clerks, you know, salespeople. And I was checking with them on, well, what's selling? And they said, well, this group, the Beach Boys. And I was aware of, you know, Surf and Safari and surfing to a degree, but it wasn't a huge hit, even on the West Coast. But they said, you know, they're up and coming. We're getting a lot of, you know, inquiries. And so I got the Surf and Safari album and listened to it. And I thought, well, these guys aren't a guitar band. These guys are a band with vocals, you know, and all these great songs that this guy, Brian Wilson, is writing. And, you know, some covers, too, because they were, you know, they did Miserlou, and, you know, Let's Go Trippin', which for Dick Dale, and they did a few other things.
Yeah.
But I just said, you know, if I'm going to get a band, I want to hear vocals. I don't want to just hear guitar music.
Yeah.
Tours or whatever. So I booked the Beach Boys, and it was a hard thing to find them. I made calls all around Southern California, and I kept getting leads, you know, who books them and who's responsible for them. I called this guy named, what was his? He had a strange name, Harvey Kleschmeyer. That was his name. And he said, oh, yeah, I can get the Beach Boys. They're $500 or $600, he told me. And I said, okay. I said, I'll keep that in mind. That's a little bit over our budget, but, you know, at least I know you have it. Mm-hmm. So I made one more call to Capitol. I don't even know why I did, but I called Capitol Records and I got in hold of somebody in publicity. And she said, well, I think the Beach Boys have just signed with the William Morris agency in Beverly Hills. So I called William Morris, and they answered the phone. And William Morris, Beverly Hills. And I said, yeah, I'm Fred Vail. I'm in Sacramento. I want to book the Beach Boys to a concert in Sacramento. And she said, the Beach Boys? I've not heard of the Beach Boys. And I said, well, I think they've just been signed. So they transferred me up to Variety. I got a woman on the phone. She said, yeah, I'll turn you over. They've just been signed. I'll turn you over to their agent, Marshall Burrell. So I got on the phone with Marshall, told him I needed the Beach Boys. He said, when? I said, Friday or Saturday, May 23rd, 24th, 25th, somewhere in there. And I said, you know, I'd like him for one, you know, for a show, for a concert, you know, not a dance, but a concert.
Yeah.
And he said, well, I'll check. Your dad, Murray, is their manager. I'll check with him and I'll get back to you. And I said, well, how much will it be? And he said, it'll be $500, or I think he said $400. It'll be $400. I said, okay. I had already saved $100, so I was happy camping.
Yeah.
And so he calls me back the next day and he said, well, I can get them on the 24th. But because their guitar player, the youngest Beach Boy, Carl Wilson, is still in high school and he doesn't get out of high school till, 3 o'clock, they can't possibly drive, you know, 450 miles to Sacramento and be there for an 8 o'clock show. So we can either have you pay for 6 round trip airline tickets or a flat $750. And I said, oh, I'll take the flat, you know, $750, then they can deal with it. the tickets. And but I found out later that if they could drive to a gig in 1963, because Carl got out of school at three. So in San Bernardino, you know, Santa Barbara, San Diego, Palmdale, Palm Springs, if they could drive there, they were working for $350 to $450 a night. Mm. That's what you could buy the Beach Boys for in the spring of 1963, which is about what it is for a meet and greet at a Brian Wilson concert.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah, not quite. Yeah, half of a meet and greet.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's what it was. So I booked them, and then, you know, I picked them up at the airport in my folks station wagon. They did two short sets. Half of it was cover songs, Misery Lou, Let's Go Trippin', Graduation Day. Denny did The Wanderer, trying to remember some of the other songs. Al did Runaway.
Cool.
they were a lot of it was cover. They didn't have all the hits yet. They'd right. had Out Surfing. They'd gone to number 75, sold about 40,000 pieces. Candex went under, couldn't afford to put out a second single. Murray shopped the group all over town. Dot Records turned them down. Went to Capitol, saw my friend Ken Nelson, who set him up with Nick Benet. Beach Boys get signed to Capitol. They put out, you know, the first album, Surfing Safari. It goes to number 13. It's gone up. They go from 75 to 13, you know, and then right about the time that I signed them, they put out Surfing USA, which was the deal breaker. I mean, that was the one that launched them, you know, because Surfing Safari are... Surfing USA went to number three, big record, you know, top five.
So Freddie, so when you had them at the high school, had Surfing USA been released yet as a single?
It had just been, as a matter of fact, it had been released probably in late March, I'm guessing.
Somebody else. You probably caught them at a pretty good time then.
Well, I taught them at a great time. As a matter of fact, again, the Lord was shining on Fred Vail. The week before I brought them to the Sacramento Auditorium, it peaked at number one on KROI and KXOY.
In Sacramento.
40 stations in Sacramento. Number one, numero uno. So I couldn't have done it better.
You look like a king.
Yeah. So, you know, I paid the guys and they, you know, I brought them on. And after the show's over, we went over to the Mansion Inn Hotel, two or three blocks from the auditorium, and we had dinner. It was a long table, Murray and the five guys. Now, Brian was not on that trip, you know, and Dave Marks was with him. So it was, you know, it was Mike, Carl, Dennis, Dave, and Bruce, or not Bruce, I'm sorry, Mike, Carl, Dennis, Dave, and who am I missing?
Al.
Yeah. Right. So, you know, so we're sitting down and we're having hamburgers and hot dogs, and shakes and stuff. And Carl asked his dad, he said, Pop, how much do we make tonight? And said, well, Mr. Vail, he called me Mr. Vail. I'm 19 years old. He said, Mr. Vail paid us $750, but after the William Morris Commission and the agency commission and the round trip airline tickets and a couple of hotel rooms, they used to all double and triple up in the States. He said, you guys each made $50 to $55, $60 each, you know, which is, you know, a lot of money back then, but not what they make later.
Sure.
And so Carl looked over at me and said, well, Fred, how much did you and the class make? And I said, well, the class made $4,000 and I got 15%. So I got $600. And they couldn't believe it, that this kid, 19-year-old kid, had made 10 times what each of the Beach Boys had made. So Murray, and he was asking me all these questions about how did I do it and all this sort of stuff. And I said, William Morris doesn't know what they've got. They didn't ask me any questions about gross potential and, you know, how their records are doing or how many people to expect or what the ticket prices were. They were just filling a calendar of dates, you know. And they didn't know you were going to end up being a big group years later.
Right.
So I ended up meeting them in the next Saturday. I went with two friends down to the Rio Nido Ballroom in the Russian River, which was a resort community north of San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And I met with them then. And there's a picture of that meeting. And you can see the five guys in their Pendletons. It's on my website. Mm-hmm. And then I met with them in L.A., flew down to L.A. and met with them in, I think it was June, and we set up the first show, and then it just kind of grew from there. So we're doing these shows, And I said, do secondary cities. You know, let William Morris book you in New York and Chicago and Miami and Philadelphia and LA. You know, you, let them do that. We'll do the secondary markets where the kids are starved for entertainment. So, you know, we started doing shows in Reno and Fresno and Stockton and Marysville, Yuba City, the night of the Kennedy assassination. And along about, I think it was around October, we had done the Sacramento, the second Sacramento show in September. It's, the poster is called Big Green. It's, you can maybe find it on the internet, probably. But it's September 14th, Sacramento Auditorium. And we did a kiddie matinee. So the parents got in free with a child. And that was one for one. You know, it's like a twofer. And we did the matinee for the kids at 3, and then we did the evening show for teenagers at 8. And along about that time, I went to Brian and Murray, and I said, you know what? We ought to record a concert. And they looked at me like I was a little bit crazy. And, well, who'd want to buy a concert album? And I said, well, the kids that go to your shows will want one as a souvenir so they can relive the excitement of a Beach Boy concert. And the kids that have never seen you because you haven't played their market yet, they'll want to buy one to see what it's like to go to a Beach Boy concert. So I said, it's a win-win. And so they finally said they'd do it. So Chuck Britz brought some portable equipment up to the Sacramento Memorial Auditorium on December 21st, Carl's 17th birthday. They set it up in the custodian's shop area where all the cleaning fluids were kept and the mops and all that sort of stuff. And we did the show, you know, the line I introduced them that night with that famous introduction that introduced your show. Are you guys using that?
Oh, yeah, we are. Yeah, it's at the beginning of our show.
Well, I introduced
show.
Myself tonight, basically.
Pretty much. Yeah, you did.
We actually, so that's how it came about. That's how the live album came about. And I didn't know it was going to be a keeper. You know, it was just a spontaneous thing. And I'd actually said, for a fabulous Christmas concert and recording session. And they Chuck just edited out the word Christmas. Mm. So it was fabulous, you know, concert and recording session, the fabulous Beach Boys. And that stuck. And that's, you know, sold, I don't know, it's up around 2 million copies now, I think.
That was their first number one record, I believe.
It was their
right?
first number one and their first gold.
Yeah.
And awesome. And then later, years later, Pickwick, which was a cutout label, discounted records you'd find at Walmart or, you know, Kresge's or whatever. They did another version of it. It's called Wow, a Great Concert on Pickwick. And that's out there floating around too.
I think you have that, Greg, that Wow, Great Concert. Remember, you used to have that record. The Pickwick one. Yeah. I think you used to have it. I remember.
Yeah. It's a white cover, really plain.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think I do.
It.
Hey, Fred, I wanted to go back when you were talking about Tower Records.
Yeah.
It's so romantic in so many ways because, you know, you go in and there's a new record and you can touch it, you can pick it up and you listen to it. Can you talk about,
One other thing.
Yeah.
What did you forget? You could touch it. You could pick it up.
Well, you could listen to it too, right?
Yeah, but what else? This is the most important part.
You could.
Is it the smell?
You could smell it.
Oh. Yeah. The vinyl.
And that's the thing. I wish. Yeah. I mean, I we obviously have records now that are kind of making a comeback. You know, the vinyl.
Yeah.
But
Don't,
I don't know that I probably smell the same thing that you could have back in the day. But let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Streaming. You know, it's becoming more and more of a problem for for artists,
right?
Because they're making so little. Do you have any? I mean, what are your thoughts on kind of today's distribution versus? Because you were at the forefront. You were literally witnessing. You're there,
right?
As records and music distribution is becoming a thing. When you look at like music today,
right?
Do you think it's a good thing that I can open up my phone and listen to Kokomo or whatever it may, you know, Surfing USA in a matter of milliseconds, or do you think there was something to, you know, having to go over and put it on a record? You know what I mean? I guess.
Well, I mean, the whole, to me, when Tower came into financial difficulties, probably 20 years ago, I'm thinking.
Yeah.
And they eventually would file for bankruptcy. And it was interesting. when they went through the bankruptcy process, Tower itself had very, very few assets. Mm-hmm. And there, as far as I know, and I might stand corrected on this, but as far as I know, the number one asset of Tower Records was that they owned the famous Sunset Strip Tower Records store. Mm-hmm. And that was just torn down recently. There's a picture of it on the internet that Tower Records and Sunset, it was torn down. And because they would lease all their stores in shopping malls and, you know, mm-hmm. shopping strip centers and, you know, downtown Trafalgar Square in London and Japan and New Orleans, Jackson Square, they were all leased. So they didn't have the asset, whereas the Sunset store they owned and it was worth quite a bit of money. But yeah, I mean, there was something about shopping in a record store, you know, particularly the clerks knew, you know, when you go to a Kmart, a big box store, a Kmart or a Walmart or something like that, they might have worked in housewares that morning and they're over in the record department that afternoon and mm-hmm. night they're back selling televisions or whatever. Mm. They didn't know the music. When you walked into a Tower Records, they knew the music. They were music junkies. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did this interview for the Sacramento Bee. Mm-hmm. And I said, for us music junkies, Tower Records was Mecca. Couldn't get any better than that.
Yeah.
You know, and then they would open up the big store at Columbus Square in San Francisco and then LA a short time later. And then they just started to grow just enormously. And they were the biggest retail record store in the world. And then they went up against downloading and book sales started to give way to Kindle and, you know, magazines started to, you know, go out of business and they, you know, they had Tower Books and they lost money in that arena. So it was, you know, but I was there at the right place at the right time.
Yeah. Can you tell, you know, kind of talking, I know we wanted to kind of touch on some of the other artists that you've worked with, obviously the Beach Boys being a big one. Matt and I were talking, Matt, both of our favorite group besides the Beach Boys, I think, is without a doubt Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons.
Four Seasons.
Now, can you tell us maybe your first interaction with them? Kind of, you have any good Four Seasons stories for us?
Well, I got a great Four Seasons story, but you got to remember the time, 62, 63, 64. Bob Crew was the Brian Wilson of the East Coast, you know, and he was their producer. Yeah. An incredible guy, very knowledgeable. I never met him, would have loved to have met him, but I never did. But he had this group, Four Seasons, Frankie and Bob Gaudio and these guys, one of which just passed in the last couple of years.
Tommy DeVito, right?
Yeah, Nick, Tom DeVito.
Nick Massey died relatively.
Oh, Nick Massey, yeah.
Not too long ago, right?
You know, so when I wasn't doing Beach Boys shows, I was doing what we call appreciation shows for radio stations. Mm-hmm. And one that I did not book, but I went to was KYA Radio in San Francisco at the Cow Palace, which make a note because I want to bring it up again about that show. But let me get back to the Sacramento thing. So I was doing this, and I was doing concerts for KXOA, and I booked in September of 63, I booked a big, what they call an appreciation show. It's a package show. I put it together. Some package shows you bought as a package, like the Dick Clark Caravan of Stars was a package. You bought the package.
Okay.
This one I handpicked. I put it together, and I had Freddie Cannon was on it, and I'm trying to think. Johnny Burnett was on it. The Coasters were on it. I booked Paul Peterson, and he canceled it about a week before the show. So I got another artist who had a record out, a guy named Ray Peterson, and we became lifelong friends. We were going to talk about Ray a little bit later.
Oh yeah.
But so I was doing these appreciation shows, and you know, I'd make the booking money. I wouldn't get a box office. I wouldn't get a piece of the action. Like when I did a show with Murray and the Boys, I would get a flat fee based on how much the entertainment cost or whatever, a marketing fee. And it was like, it was fun doing these things because, you know, like I said, I'd been making $1.50, $2 an hour in radio, and I could pick up, you know, easily, you know, 4 or 5 times that by doing one of these shows, maybe 10 times that doing a show. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then I was kind of making the transition. So when in between some Beach Boys shows, I got a call from John Bayless, the general manager of KXOA, and he said, would you find another act? We'd like to do another show. And I said, well, let's do the Four Seasons. And he said, great. And I said, well, we'll need an opening act. And so I called this woman. Her name was Julie Stedham. She was at General Artists Corporation, GAC, which is kind of now it's called CAA, Creative Artists Agency. It was William Morris's main competition in the agency. Uh-huh. And so Julie, I ended up getting the Crickets as the opening act for the Four Seasons. Now this is post Buddy Holly.
Buddy Holly, yeah.
Jerry Naylor is the lead singer. But Jerry Allison, J.I., who co-wrote That'll Be the Day and whose girlfriend was Peggy Sue, the real Peggy Sue.
Yeah.
He was in the band, the drummer. And so was, I'm trying to think, Glenn Hardin, who ended up being in Elvis's band. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to think who else was in the group. There's a couple other, the bass player. Shoot. These names are not hitting on all four cylinders tonight. But anyway, so I get the Crickets. So the Crickets open for the Beach Boys for the Four Seasons at the auditorium. So they're the opening act, and they do all the Buddy Holly songs. It's not a Buddy Holly,
right?
And then it's time to bring on the Four Seasons. Well, it was March 25th, 1964, which was literally the day after my 20th birthday. So, and I was still living at home when I wasn't on the road. I didn't have an apartment. I lived with my folks, and I was on the road all the time setting up shows. And so I get this knock at the door at my house, and I go to the front door, and it's about noon, give or take. Mm-hmm. And I open up the door, and it's Carl and Denny. And they'd come up to take their buddy Fred to dinner, celebrate his birthday, and to go to the Four Seasons concert.
Out of nowhere, they just thought of you.
That is so awesome.
I mean, literally.
What a story.
So we go down to the auditorium, and
that's great.
The auditorium, it's 5,300 seat auditorium, and left and right of the stage there were these backstage doors, and they were by the snack bars. You literally had to walk by the snack bar to get to the backstage door, and at some point during the intermission, when everybody's going to get Cokes and popcorn and candy bars and all that, somebody had spotted Dennis and Carl. They either had spotted them when the stage door opened, or they had spotted them off the stage, off of stage right, in the wings. And so when the four Seasons come out to do their second set, all of a sudden, the word started to spread around the auditorium that there are two Beach Boys here tonight. And the kids are stomping and calling out, Beach Boys, Beach Boys.
Oh, no.
All that right in the middle of the fourth season set. And it was going crazy. And the cops turned the house lights up, turned them up. And finally, Dennis and Carl walked out on stage, and they were very nice, and they said, listen, we're going to be back in May. They said, we're up here to celebrate Fred's birthday. That's what we're up here for. And you guys need to let the Four Seasons do their show. Mm-hmm. They're the stars tonight.
Yeah.
And then the kids quieted down. Four Seasons went on with their show. And that was how I spent my 20th birthday. Being taken out to dinner by the two Beach Boys and putting on a Four Seasons show.
Man.
Fred, how did the Four Seasons feel about that? Did they kind of understand that?
They understood.
The Beach Boys were popular?
They were great. Yeah. They were very gracious,
Yeah.
And, they just wanted to let the kids see that, Denny and Carl, and acknowledge that they were there.
Yeah.
And then things went back to normal and they started doing their hits.
Were they pretty good? Were they pretty good live?
Yeah, they were good live.
Well, Matt, we need to link that YouTube clip from that Clearwater, Florida show in 1964. The Four Seasons, for some reason, have, like, there's almost zero live material out there for the Four Seasons, and I don't understand it. But recently, we came upon, Fred, a YouTube clip. It's almost like a radio recording of them in 64. And I got to tell you, man, Frankie Valli, that guy.
He could sing.
That guy could sing live.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. He was great. Yeah. He was fantastic. Yeah. So,
well, they're making a lot of money off the Jersey Boys, or at least Bob Gaudio.
That's right.
Somebody is. I don't know who is.
Bob Gaudio. He was the primary writer.
Yeah.
And he lives here now, by the way.
He does. Yeah.
I've been meaning to look him up. I don't know anybody that knows him. I've got to make a good friend of mine, Dave Pomeroy, is the president of the Nashville Musicians Union. And I'm sure Dave knows him. And I got to call Dave and said, I got to get hooked up with Gaudio, because I want to ask him if he remembers that night in Sacramento.
Yeah.
That the Beach Boys showed up.
Oh, I bet he does.
That's great.
Oh, I guarantee you he remembers it.
Well, I'm not inviting us, Fred, but we'll be there. And if you'd like to take us along, we'll be your personal assistants. We'll open the door for you.
Oh, to meet Gaudio, you mean?
Yeah. We'll wear sunglasses and shirt and tie and that kind of thing. That's cool.
Yeah.
Rent a fancy car. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
All right. So Four Seasons. What other groups? What other big acts did you get any good stories from any other groups?
Well. Zagrilli, I mean, the story about Ray Peterson replacing Paul Peterson at the last minute, and Ray had basically retired. I just looked up Ray's bio in Wikipedia, and it actually mentions me and said that Sacramento promoter named Fred Vail brought him back to prominence in the early 60s because he recorded that Good Night, My Love, which is the classic closing dance song. If you went to a prom or a dance in the late 1950s, early 60s, typically it would end with Good Night, My Love. It was your last chance to get that up close, you know, hug from your main squeeze from your girlfriend.
Yeah.
The slow dance, right? And Jesse Belvin had the first hit on it in 56. Ray had a hit on it in 59. Paul Anka had a hit on it in 68, but I mean, it's what they call an evergreen, which means it makes money forever.
Right.
And the Fleetwoods cut it. Paula Abdul has cut it. Gloria Estefan has cut it.
Yeah.
I think the Four Seasons did. Yeah. They got a great recording of it.
So, it's a great song. So I get Ray to substitute for Paul Peterson. We didn't keep it a secret. We told the kids that Paul Peterson, who's star of the Donna Reed Show, can't make it. We're going to substitute Ray Peterson. Has a record out called I Forgot What It Was Like. It's going up the charts. And he also had The One to Review, and he had, you know, Good Night, My Love, and he had Tell Laura I Love Her, and he had Karina. But his career had been at a standstill, and I found him back home. He'd moved back from L.A. back to Denton, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And I called him up, and I said, I don't even know how I found him, but I did some work, and I found him. And I said, I'm Fred Vail. I'm a promoter. I'm bringing in a package show in September. And, you know, we've had one of our artists has dropped out, and I'd love to get you on the show. You're one of my favorite singers. And he was very gracious. And he said, well, I haven't done it in a while. I've pretty much given up. I later found out that the Dunes Records was a partnership with him and his manager, Stan Shulman. And Stan had built him out of money, and he was really despondent and had given up on music. Mm-hmm. And I convinced him to come to Sacramento and do this show, and he agreed to. And I got him on the show, so he's on this show with you know Freddie Cannon and Johnny Burnett was on the show, and the Coasters were on the show. We said Blue Notes were on the show, another surfing band.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember, either the Rivingtons or the Righteous Brothers. One of the two was on that show. But anyway, so he did this show, and he blows everybody away. Ray did. I mean, the guy had a perfect pitch and a 4.5 octave range. You talk about Frankie Valli, he would give Frankie Valli a run for the money any day of the week.
Ooh. Yeah.
You know,
wow.
Great. And he did these great songs. And it just, it was the right time. And the kids loved him. And it just rejuvenated him to get back in the, to get back in the game.
Yeah.
And I said, I can book you. I know I can book you in clubs. I can book you at, you know, restaurant, you know, ballrooms and, you know, places like Lou. And it started going up the charts again. I think the first time out in 60, 59, 60, it had gone to like, I don't know, 7 or 10 or something. The reissue went to like 70, you know, not a huge hit, but enough to get a lot of bookings. And then you started working in LA on the Sunset Strip at Guzzari's and all that. So, and we became lifelong friends. And when I met my former, my first wife, Deb, Brenda, mm-hmm. She was a Ray Peterson fan because she had been dating his guitar player.
Uh-huh.
And so I met her, and they split up, and I met her at a Ray Peterson show in Baltimore, Maryland. And I ended up getting her number and coming back from Baltimore, heading back to Nashville and Atlanta. I ended up, you know, meeting her, and we ended up getting married the following June of 72. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, Ray and his former wife, Carol, who was, he was married to at the time, came over, and Ray sang Ave Maria and The Wonder of You at our wedding. Right.
Really? Mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
So then in 74, I moved to Nashville, and he's here in Nashville.
Yeah.
And we see each other almost every week. We love Mexican food, and we'd go out and have Mexican food and get caught up and all that. And he had become a what are you going to call him? A preacher, evangelical type of preacher, had a ministry by then. He was very, you know, a believer in the Lord. And he and his wife, Claudia, and their two daughters traveled around the South and Southeast doing testimonies and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And then in 2004, he was diagnosed with bladder cancer. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty aggressive. And on January 25th of 2005, he passed away. I was with him the night before until early in the morning, and then he passed that afternoon. So Claudia asked me if I would give the eulogy at his funeral.
Wow.
And one of the toughest things I ever did, you know, it's kind of like me telling the story about Jay Cook and WFIL that he wouldn't play Adson music here today. These boys aren't hip anymore. Well, it's almost like that. I had found out that the guy that wrote The Wonder of You, Baker Knight was his name, mm-hmm. and he was living in Alabama. And he'd wrote The Wonder of You, and he'd also wrote Lonesome Town for Ricky Nelson, one of Ricky Nelson's first big hits,
mm-hmm.
and a great writer. And I called him up, and I said, I'm Fred Vail. I'm a lifelong friend of Ray Peterson. I said, mm-hmm. I just want you to know I'm using The Wonder of You for my eulogy, and, you know, kind of the cornerstone of my eulogy.
Yeah.
And he said, Fred, you wouldn't believe it. He said, when I wrote that song in 1957, 58, he said, there was no CCM. There was no contemporary Christian music market like there is now. Mm-hmm. It was either black gospel or, you know, Southern gospel, you know, the Blackwood Brothers and the Stamps Quartet and the Jordanaires. There was no Michael W. Smith and Sandy Patty, Stephen Curtis Chapman, and Michael English. There wasn't any of that going on. He said, I couldn't get it recorded. You know, it was a Christian song, but I couldn't get it recorded. So I ended up, you know, sending it out, and ended up Ray Peterson cuts it. And he said, but it's a Christian song. And he said, so appropriate to use that as the cornerstone for Ray's eulogy, because when no one else can understand you, when everything you do is wrong, you give me hope and consolation, you give me strength to carry on. That was about the Lord. That wasn't about his girlfriend.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was the way you interpret it. That, you know, it shifted from about Jesus Christ
right
to a girlfriend, somebody that believes in you. So that's the story of Ray. And you know, the guy, I hope that people will, you know, go back and hear some of these great records that some of these artists did that were ahead yeah. of their time. When I did Johnny, when I booked Johnny Burnett in at that concert in 63, the same as, you know, Freddie Cannon was on the show, Ray was on the show.
Yeah.
Johnny had just had a group with his brother Dorsey and a guitar player named Paul Burleson. And they worked out of Memphis. They lived in Memphis. And this was 1952, 53. Mm-hmm. They were doing rockabilly music before Carl Perkins and before Elvis. Mm-hmm. They were a trio in Memphis. They were inspiring Carl Perkins and Elvis, if you can believe yeah. that. They were called the Rock and Roll Trio. You can look them up on Wikipedia or mm-hmm. Google them. They were great. And they are sadly lacking, just like Brian. They're sadly lacking from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They're early influences for rock and roll. With yeah. no question. I don't know how you overlook people like Brian Wilson as an individual, as an innovator, as a producer, as a vocalist, as an arranger. Right. How do you overlook him for the rock and roll when you put in the four Beatles individually? How do you do that? How do you put in Eric Clapton four times and Brian Wilson isn't in one time? How do you do that? You know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
So Jan and Dean aren't in. They should be, and they should have been in 10, 15 years ago. They should have been in while Jan was still alive.
Yeah.
You know, now if they go in, you know, it's posthumously. Paul Revere and the Raiders, Paul should have gone in, you know, and during his lifetime, and he didn't. And it's kind of a pet peeve. Sid Bernstein, the guy that brought the Beatles to Shea Stadium. Before that, he promoted Frank Sinatra and Ella Fitzgerald and all these great artists. He should be in. He's the guy that opened up stadiums and arenas to rock and roll acts. Crazy. You know, they were doing auditoriums and theaters, and then Sid Bernstein puts the Beatles in Shea Stadium, and everything changes. You know, and he's not in, and he should be in. So it's like they just, you know, you can't see the forest for the trees. They're, it just doesn't make any sense.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, that stuff today is it's you got to be relevant now, right? So it's got to, you got to sell.
Or you got to be a liberal politician to appease John Winter. One or the other.
Fred.
And that's another story at another date.
Yeah. You mentioned the Righteous
Brothers.
You don't
want to do this show about politics. Don't get me started.
Hey, we'll do a show called Liberal Talk, and you can come on. It'll be fun.
Liberal Talk.
Yeah. No, I'm just kidding. Fred, tell us about, you mentioned the Righteous Brothers. Did you ever get a chance to hang out with the Righteous Brothers or see them or work with them?
A great story about the Righteous Brothers. In December of 60, I think it was December of 64, Tom Donahue, who was a DJ at KYA Radio in San Francisco, and his DJ partner, Bobby Mitchell. Donahue and Mitchell did a show at the Cow Palace. It was an appreciation show. And I go down to see the boys, right? The Beach Boys are on the show.
Okay.
And when I go in, my friend Ron was with me and my friend Mike, and we go in. And we see this black guy backstage, didn't pay any attention really, because we were there to see, you know, the Beach Boys.
Right.
And Jan and Dean were on the show. April Stevens and Nino Temple were on the show. The Righteous Brothers were on the show. The Ronettes were on the show. Dee Dee Sharp, the Mashed Potato Girl, was on the show. Jose Jimenez, the astronaut, the comedian, he was on the show. Chuck Berry was on the show. It's a huge show.
Real.
They had a house band. Now, back in those days, you would bring sheet music and you'd give it to the band and they'd play and accompany you. And so they had this big band, probably 20 pieces. The guy on guitar, lead guitar, was Sylvester Stewart, who became Sly of the Family Stone, right?
Awesome.
And then they had this guy leading the band in a black tuxedo playing a red Epiphone. I will never forget this picture. He's dressed to the tens or nines or whatever you call it, in his tuxedo, and he's playing this red Epiphone. And it's a guy named Phil Spector. That's the band leader, right?
No way.
So Spector hears the Righteous Brothers, who are on this Moonglow Records, a little independent label, probably on his last leg. And he says, when you guys, when your contract is up, or when Moonglow folds, whichever comes first, I really like you guys. I like what I heard tonight. I'd like to produce you. So he does. And out of that association partnership, You've Lost That Love and Feeling, which is one of the greatest rock and roll records of all time, right?
Man.
So we're doing this show, and Dee Dee Sharp's on the show, and there's an intermission, right?
Yeah.
And Tom Donahue comes out in the stage to kibitz with the audience. And he said, I'd like to, we got an extra attraction tonight. Dee Dee Sharp brought her boyfriend. You know, will you come out and say hi to the folks? It was Cassius Clay that I had seen backstage before he became Muhammad Ali.
No way. What was he?
He was dating Dee Dee Sharp, the Mashed Potato Girl.
Wow.
So that, I mean, stories like that, you know, it doesn't get better.
Fred, when's your book coming out, man? You have so many stories.
Well, you know, two things. Cows in the Pasture, or whatever you want to call it,
yes,
in the book. You know, that's a constant question. My wife asked me every other day. My friend Dick Andrews asked me whenever we talk. You know, I'm just got to work on it. Russ Smith, got to work on it. You know, I have so many people that are pushing me to write it, but it's like all of a sudden a day goes by, a week goes by, a month goes by, a year goes by, and I haven't written the book yet.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. And the problem is Ben Valley, who's probably listening tonight from Cincinnati or Newport News, Virginia, depending upon where he is.
Hey, Ben.
Hey, Ben.
Shout out to Ben.
Shout out to Ben.
He's always, you know, talking to me about the book.
Yeah.
The problem is that my life has been a blessing. I mean, I told a guy on Facebook today, I said, I basically turned my love for music into a career that's now in its 65th year.
Yeah.
From the time I was 12 years old on KRAK radio as a teen announcer, doing dedications and giving sports news during Randy Hartley's Saturday morning radio program, to now at Treasure Isle, working with Jason Aldean and all these great artists that, you know, that we've recorded.
Yeah.
You know, my life's been a blessing. I've lived the dream, you know, I mean, and I tell people this, I told a guy on Facebook today, his name is Frank. He may be listening. So Frank, if you're listening,
hey Frank,
welcome to Beach Boys Live, and meet Mac and Matt and Greg. Anyway, I told him, I said, listen, I've been speaking to colleges and high school groups since I was in college, you know, because I was a freshman at Sac State when I brought the Beach Boys in.
Right.
So I would speak to journalism classes and they'd interview me and, you know, all this sort of stuff. And I said, you know, if you never want to work a day in your life, find something you love to do so much you would do it for free, and then perfect that talent until somebody will pay you to do that for them.
Yeah.
And you'll never work a day in your life.
Mm.
So basically, you know, I've made a living, sometimes better than others, doing what I love to do, doing what I would have done for free. I mean, I've hung out with my heroes since 1958, I think I was 50. I was 1958, so I would have been 14 years old when I interviewed Ricky Nelson on the set of Ozzie and Harriet, and Jimmy Rogers when he came to play the California State Fair in Sacramento. And you know, a couple years later, I interviewed Jane Mansfield, one of the sex symbols of the 1950s and 60s. Interview her backstage in her dressing room on the movie set of the George Raft story. And I spent about 4 hours on set while they were filming this movie. Ray Danton played George Raft and Jane Mansfield played his main squeeze. And so I'm having lunch with the crew. I'm a kid, you know, I'm like 17 maybe, something like that. And I'm waiting to see Jane and I'm out. And they had food truck and they would cater meals you know, to the set. It was an exterior shot at a house on North Rushmore, which North Rushmore at, it's either at Santa Monica Boulevard, North Rushmore becomes Vine Street, you know, which is where Capitol Records 1750 North Vine. So I'm in this front lawn at picnic tables with the cast and the crew having lunch, and the guy across the table from me, literally in the beginnings of his career as a comedian, turned the Joker, named Frank Gorshin.
No way.
I'm having lunch with Frank Gorshin. Now, I, you know, he was nobody in 1960. Right. You know, I didn't even know who he was. But boy, a few years later, we knew who he was. Man. You know, but he was the Joker or the Riddler, one or the other. But anyway, yeah. Frank Gorshin, Batman. So, I mean, it's just been a series of great, you know, stories, great tales, great experiences. You know, front row for all this, you know, music and see my heroes. And George Martin, perfect example. You know, meeting George Martin in the Waldorf Astoria Ballroom in 1970. I was out in the road. It was the same trip that I went to see Jay Cooke to add some music to Sunflower album. And believe it or not, it was right. He was like the morning keynote speaker, and he gets done with his speech. Now that McCartney had announced in April that the Beatles were splitting up. This is 70, right? And this is now June. And of course, George Martin and the Beach Boys and the Beatles were, you know, they were all friends and admirers of each other, respected each other. And so I had told the boys, and, you know, when I left, I said, I'm going to see George Martin. And they said, well, when you see him, you know, tell him hi from the Beach Boys, and we look forward to seeing him on a future trip across the pond.
Yeah.
And so I waited for a couple people. People didn't mob him. It was just a couple people in front of me to go up and shake his hand. So yeah. I go up to George Martin, and he wasn't knighted then. This is 1970. And I go up and, you know, I introduce myself. I said, I'm Fred Vail. I manage the Beach Boys. I'm on the road promoting their new album, Sunflower. And he looked and he said, Fred, you know, Brian's a genius. And I said, yeah, I've heard that a few times. I said, yeah, I said, they just want you to know that welcome to the country, you know, to the U.S. And they look forward to seeing you on a future trip. And the 16-track recorder had just come out.
Yeah.
And Brian had one in his house in Bellagio in Bel Air. And I had recorded on it with the country album, which 16-track, at Wally Hyder's. And I just thought I'd throw it out. You know, I said, well, George, what do you think of this new 16-track analog recorder? And I'll never forget this. You guys would appreciate this. He just kind of stops, you know. He looks at me and he rubs his chin. And he said, well, you know, Fred, if you need more than four tracks, you better find an act with more talent. And he's right.
Wow.
The greatest music of the rock era was recorded mono, two, three, or four tracks.
Right.
Including Pet Sounds and Sgt. Pepper.
Yeah.
Four tracks.
Unreal.
Now you have unlimited tracks with Pro Tools.
Right.
You know, you could have 60, 80 tracks. You know, they did it on two, four tracks and Ingenuity. You know, that's, you know, they could, you know, they could, you know, bump it to combine two tracks to one and then open up a track and do an overdub and combine that to the other two and then do another overdub. You know, they just found a way to do this all, you know, by sheer ingenuity, you know. And of course, the leaders, the forefront of that were George Martin in England at Abbey Road and Brian and Chuck and at, you know, Western United and Gold Star and, you know, all and, you know, Capital A. So, I mean, it's just, you know, it's amazing that I meet all these people. But getting back to the book.
Yeah.
I didn't keep notes. I didn't keep a diary. There were no cameras to do selfies. Right. Can you imagine me having a picture of me and Rick Nelson on the set of Ozzy and Harriet, or a picture of me and
awesome.
George Martin?
Yeah.
Or a picture of me in the Four Seasons, or a picture with me and so many other picture of me and the Beach Boys. I'm amazed that there aren't that many pictures of me and the Beach Boys. I mean, there's a couple really great pictures. You know, Carl, bless his heart, they came to Nashville. They were doing an album, Red, White, and Blue album. Yeah. And they did a video at a soundstage in East Nashville. And there was a photographer there taking pictures of the guys. So, you know, of course, Denny wasn't in it, but, you know, Carl and Bruce and Mike and Al and Brian were there. And they're taking these photos, and they get done, and we go outside, and they found a hot rod, like a Ford, like a Little Deuce Coupe type of hot rod. Mm-hmm. And they were taking pictures in the parking lot with them all surrounding the hot rod. And they get done, and we're getting ready to say goodbye, because I was going to see them the next day. Mm-hmm. They played Fanfare, I believe. And Carl said, "Oh, Fred, we should have had you in our portrait picture." And I didn't even think of it, you know. I mean, it would have been a great picture. It would have been one of the final pictures with the group as we know and love, you know, minus Dennis, but everybody else was there. But it was just little flukes like that you don't think about, but you think about it in retrospect, you know, what if, and you know, that's a huge, what if I kept a diary? What if I had a cell phone that had a camera? You know, back in those days, they didn't even have those little disposable grab shot cameras.
Right.
Didn't even have those. So if you wanted to take a picture inside, you had to fill your pockets with flash bulbs and, you know, use your Brownie or one of the other Kodak cameras. And it was a big chore, you know. And like in the case of Ricky Nelson, you know, they didn't allow cameras on the set of Ozzy and Harriet. So I probably couldn't add a picture with him anyway.
Mm.
So, you know, it's just circumstance. It's just the way it is, you know.
Well,
doing the country album, doing the book, they're on my agenda. You know, it's just a question of doing it, you know.
Well, Fred, I feel like you could almost write a book. You could write a book about your experiences, obviously, and it would be amazing. I would be interested if you would write a book about how, especially in this day and age, I don't know if our generation or whatever, but I would love a book on how to live in the moment, you know, how to be able to completely immerse yourself day by day in what you're doing. Because you talking through, you know, not having the ability to record, to take pictures or selfies or that kind of thing. But man, Fred, you remember in this great detail, almost every minute, almost minute by minute, some of these stories. And
yeah,
that's a gift, right?
I know it is a gift, and I'm more appreciative of every day. I'm a little bit hoarse tonight. I don't have what Dave Leaf called my DJ voice. I don't have that on tonight. It's not bad, but it's not at its best form tonight. But you know, I have been blessed, and I don't take it for granted. I don't think I ever did. You know, because it opened so many doors, you know, because radio kicked it off. You know, I was growing up at a great time. Rock and roll was, you know, emerging, you know, this 56, 54, 55, 56, doo-wop out of New York. And the West Coast sound hadn't really been developed at that point other than soundtracks. I mean, you know, if you were a recording artist who was an actor or an actress, Frank Sinatra, Doris Day, Nat King Cole, Elvis, you know, you would record basically in LA because that's where the studios were, the film studios. If you were a Broadway star like Ethel Merman or Harry Belafonte or, you know, whoever back there, then you'd record in New York. And Nashville really didn't come about until the mid 50s. You know, Nashville, the country artists here would record in Atlanta, or they'd record in Chicago, or they'd record in Dallas. And we got our first dedicated studio here around 1955, 56. WSM Radio, which was the home of the Grand Ole Opry, would record people at the radio studio or on the stage of the Ryman Auditorium, and then they would feed it by phone line to their transmitter out in Brentwood, south of town, and they would do a live recording, or what they call direct to disc, and they would do that. And then these three engineers from WSM started the Nashville studio called, well, there was several studios. There was one in a hotel, the Tulane Hotel, which is now an office building, is torn down. And they set up a studio in the ballroom at the Tulane Hotel. And they recorded Hank Williams there, the father, and they recorded Red Foley there, and they recorded Ernest Tubb there. And then the first real independent studio was the Bradley Brothers, Owen and Harold, and they started the Quonset Hut over on 16th. They bought an old house in a neighborhood for $7,500. Mm-hmm. And they started recording in the house. And it was too small to get the sound that they wanted. So yeah, they bought an old Army Quonset Hut, Army surplus Quonset Hut, and they put it on the back of the house, and that became the Quonset Hut, which they had until they sold it to CBS, Columbia Records, in 1962. But it was there that they recorded, you know, Patsy Cline and Loretta Lynn and Conway Twitty and Marty Robbins and Johnny Cash and all these great artists. And then that Quonset Hut on 16th Avenue, 16th Avenue was a residential street running both directions, north and south. And they were basically the first music industry on music, what became Music Row. Now we call it Music Row. Mm-hmm. And it's now one way going north.
Right.
And then 17th Avenue is one way going south. Yeah. And that whole area is now Music Row. But yeah, I mean, that, and the Beach Boys did a thing there at the Quonset Hut. I wasn't there. They were on the road, and I think it was 1964, maybe they did some stuff there. I don't even know what ever came out. Buddy Holly recorded there. I don't think it came out.
Fred, there's one recording on one of those twofers of the Today album and Summer Days and Summer Nights.
Yeah.
And there's a Dance, Dance, Dance on there that was recorded in Nashville.
Oh,
maybe
that's
the same place you're talking about. I don't know the studio, but that's what it says on there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just them playing the instruments, you know, instead of the extra, you know, the wrecking crew and the extra help they had. It's a different recording.
Oh yeah. I mean, well, Nashville, though, yeah, you know, the Nashville sound, I mean, you know, Dylan did three albums here. Simon and Garfunkel did two albums.
Oh yeah.
All that was done at CBS, at Columbia Studio. Yeah. And then they tore it down to make room for the Columbia Records building, CBS building. And so they destroyed the Quonset Hut basically. And then Mike Curb gave them some money to rebuild it. But by that time, the Quonset Hut itself was gone, and they use it now for meetings. I've spoken there to groups, but they use it now more for meetings, for events. It still has a control room, but it doesn't have the curved ceiling. It doesn't have the barnwood walls. It doesn't have the shag carpet. It's like the big room, you know,
right?
Big, and it, you don't have the aura. Now RCA Studio B, historic RCA Studio B. I just spoke there 2 weeks ago on the 11th. That's still the way it was when Elvis left the building. I mean, the linoleum floors and the mood lighting and the, you know, no ISOs, baffles where they could separate the strings and the horns from the rhythm section.
Yeah.
You know, drums out on the floor with one microphone.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I mean, that's still there. Justin Croft is the manager, and the last two managers before him, Luke Gilfeather and Mike Janis, I've been speaking at RCAB off and on since 2004. Mm-hmm. I've spoken to schools, I've spoken to leadership music, I've spoken to different groups. And when I go over to RCA Studio B, it's like, I get goosebumps. I just did it 2 weeks ago, 11th of February, I spoke to leadership music. There was about 50 music industry people there. Then I'm telling them how Nashville became Music City USA. And I'm standing in the studio where Elvis recorded, where Roy Orbison recorded, where the Everly Brothers recorded. You know, I mean, Only the Lonely, you know, Crying, Claudette, Dream by Felice and Bootle O'Brien, Devoted to You, Take a Message to Mary, Hank Snow, I've Been Everywhere, Java, Al Hurt, Grammy Record. So many great records have been cut. And it's like history. And it's like I told the leadership music class, I said, when this studio opened in October 29th of 1957, I'm a 13-year-old kid listening to the records on my little blue Japanese transistor radio late at night with it under my pillow, so my parents didn't know I had the radio on when I should have been asleep getting ready for school. And I'm listening to Don Gibson, Oh Lonesome Me, and See a Heartbreak, and the Browns, Three Bells, and all these great records. And now here I am, you know, 60 years later, literally 60 plus years later.
Yeah.
And I'm speaking to people in the same room where magic took place.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's, I tell people RCA Studio B is hallowed ground. If you're a music junkie, particularly a baby boomer, it's where the action was. You know, it was only a studio for 20 years, 20 years, 57 to 77. And believe it or not, that by 77, there were commercial studios like the Quonset Hut and like, what was one of the other great studios that was down on the road? Well, Pete Drake had a studio. Porter Wagner had a studio. Trying to remember. Several other studios were, you know, by that time, independents were starting to move in, and the artists were getting away from recording at the studio owned or the label owned studio. So like out in LA, if you were a Capitol artist, you recorded at Capitol Studios. And if you were a Columbia artist, you recorded at Columbia Studios. And, you know, in that way, the label could recoup money for the recording process, which was a way of, you know, getting money back from the artist. And they were starting to go to these independent studios, just like Brian went to, you know, United Western on Sunset. And, and Gold Star and some of the other great studios out in California. But back then, as the independent studios opened, they could keep up with the gadgets and they could buy stuff and keep up with the technology. Whereas if you work at a corporate studio, RCA, the bean counters in New York were calling the shots and you had to submit, you know, purchase orders, get the approval of all, you know, independent studios just snapped it up, you know, we need a new Fairchild. Let's get one, you know, or we need a new U67, get one, you know, or 47, whatever. So they decided they'd close RCA-B. It had been 20 years, it'd been open 20 years. And Elvis had done over 200 singles there. You know, Elvis never got a Grammy for rock and roll, believe it or not. It's unreal that he never got a Grammy for rock and roll, nor did the Beach Boys. But he did his two gospel albums there, and they were the gospel albums that won him the Grammys. You know, How Great Thou Art, and the other, the second one, I can't remember. Second one, is other title. But anyway, so they decide to close RCA Studio B in 1977. It closes on August. Some people say August 16th. Some people say August 17th. Mm-hmm. It either closed on the 16th or the 17th. On the 16th, 250 miles west in Memphis, Tennessee, the king of rock and roll dies at Graceland. And that day or the day following, RCAB closes as a commercial recording studio.
Wow.
So it's like, I tell people, it's like RCAB, you know, basically says to itself, if these walls could talk, our job is finished. Yeah. Elvis is gone. Let's close the doors.
Yeah.
You know, and it's been a museum, a working museum ever since. And the Belmont students that take courses in engineering and recording use it as a laboratory, learn how to use analog.
Right.
You know, they have an API console in there now to replace the RCA or Dates that was in there at the time of Elvis. You know, Bill Porter's gone. Do you guys, you know, your guys are, you both play guitar, right?
I don't. My brother does. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, you have a foot pedal effect, most likely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And you have a fuzz tone.
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. The fuzz tone was a mistake. Marty Robbins had a hit record called El Paso. It was a famous album called Gunfighter Ballads and Trail Songs. Bright pink cover, hot pink cover. Marty's dressed as a paladin looking character in black, you know, with his six gun. And they did that album, that whole album, in 8 hours. Album in 8 hours.
Yeah.
And it has El Paso, 4 minutes and 57 seconds. The Grammy Award winner for Best Country and Western Performance.
Yeah.
You know, it wins. So it's on there. And Big Iron, another Marty Robbins hit, is on that album. So he goes into the Quonset Hut and records another record. And it was called Don't Worry. And in between the console and Grady Martin's guitar amp, there's some foul up, some mechanism shorts out, and the tube emits this fuzzy sound. Mm-hmm. And Marty didn't like it. But Don Law, the producer, said, it works. Let's leave it in. So if you listen to Don't Worry, Marty Robbins, you hear what becomes the fuzz tone.
That's cool.
I right now. Story. Now,
yeah.
It's 1961. Let's go ahead 4 years. Mm-hmm. There's this English invasion starts in basically 63. Mm-hmm. And the Beatles emerge, and the Dave Clark Five emerge, and Herman's Hermits emerges, and Pat Clark emerges, and this group called the Rolling Stones emerge. They use that effect on Satisfaction.
Oh yeah.
That was discovered at the Quonset Hut by a mistake in 1961.
Yeah. Completely different genre too.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah.
You know, basically Keith Richard caught Grady Martin's sound, and everybody uses fuzz tone now. So yeah, I mean that's just one of the little crazy things about, you know, this town, these studios, if those walls could talk, you know. Anyway.
Fred, do you mind can we take a few questions from the chat to kind of open up?
Yeah. Oh, and we were going to talk about Jan and Dean, and we didn't do that. And we talked about Ray, talked about Four Seasons, we talked about Beach Boys, talked about Righteous Brothers.
Fred, I want to Fred, we have a lot to do. Well, I want to have you back. I want to do an entire show on you and pitching Sunflower to radio stations, and that
yeah.
I want to hold. I want the tidbits on you pushing
can
that
I,
record.
Can I ask a related question to that? I was going to ask this, Fred. Yeah. You know, Feel Flows came out recently, and Greg and I have done some shows on it. And I remember you telling the story about how heartbroken you were when the DJ wouldn't play Add Some Music. Do you feel any kind of? How does it make you feel now to know that Feel Flows came out and it's successful and all these people are finally giving Sunflower its due? Yeah, that's got to feel pretty good, huh?
It feels great. I mean, there were the two albums that were during my tenure at Beach Boys, Brother Records, BBEE, Beach Boys Entertainment Enterprises, Inc., Brother Records, whatever. Two of the records that came out during my tenure, Sunflower and the Flame, Garl's Group. That's what brought me to Nashville. The deal with Mo Austin was for the Beach Boys and Brian Wilson. Mo Austin, the president of Warner Brothers Records, a great record man. He loved Brian Wilson, and he wanted to sign Brian Wilson to Warner Brothers Records. And he said, this deal is just for Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys. Mm-hmm. You know, no other artists, just Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys. That's our commitment. So when Carl found the Flame in England, and by the way, Mick Jagger also liked them and wanted to sign them, but they went with Carl. Mm-hmm. They come back and I get them their green cards, you know, the three Fattara brothers and Blondie. And I get them an apartment and I go with them on shopping sprees to the music stores when they need guitar strings and, you know, all that, and drumsticks and drum heads and all that sort of stuff. And that album, it was Carl just loved that album. Everybody at Brother and management, you know, we all loved that album. But we couldn't get it on Warner Brothers because it was only for the Beach Boys. Mm-hmm. So I didn't find the label. Nick Grillo, I think, did, or somebody did. And it was Start 8 King Records. And King was an R&B label that started in Cincinnati, Ohio. And had, of course, James Brown and Fabulous Flames. And then their country label, Starday, was Dick Pierce, and started here in Nashville. And they had George Jones at one point. They had Glenn Campbell for one album. They had Red Sovine. They had several other artists. And I came back here to meet with Hal Neely and their Wilson. What was Wilson's first name? The sales guy. His name was Wilson. Mike Kelly was the promotion guy. Hal Neely was the president. Mm-hmm. And I came back here to Nashville in 70. I think in 70, I spent 7 months on the road promoting The Flame and See the Light and The Beach Boys, Have Some Music and Sunflower. I think I spent 7 months. So I came back here. This is 1970. Mm-hmm. And I always timed it to where I would come in on Friday and meet with Hal and Jim Wilson. Jim Wilson, head of sales. And then I would stay over and go to the Ryman Auditorium on Saturday night for the Grand Ole Opry, because I got to know Hank Snow and cut one of his songs, Fool Such As I, for that Cows and Pastures album thing. So I'm coming back here, you know, and I fell in love with Nashville. I mean, it was a wholly different town then than it is now. And I, you know, I'm thinking in the back of my head, I'm thinking, you know, if I ever leave the West Coast, and I'm a West Coast guy, I'm fourth generation San Franciscan, lived in Sacramento, went and lived in LA. You know, I never was a surfer like Denny, but I was a California guy, you know. And I said, you know, if I ever, and my parents were alive, you know, mom, dad, my brother, and sister-in-law, if I ever leave California, I could see myself living here. This is 1970. I like the way of life. I like, you know, the quality of life. I like the no traffic. Now there's traffic, but
I was
wasn't then.
Say, the traffic, you know,
the music community all around Music Row. You had music publishers, you had artist managers, you had talent agents, you had studios, you know, all within five block area. The whole industry is like in, you know, between Wedgwood and Broadway,
right,
north and south, and between 16th and 21st, east and west. And that's the music business in Nashville, right? It's great, you know, and it's cheaper to rent an apartment, cheaper to buy a house, cheaper for gas. I mean, everything was great.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, you know, I could see myself living here. Well, when I left the Beach Boys, I went to work for Capitol. You know, Al Corey, one of my heroes and one of the greatest record men in the history of music. And Corey would tell me, when Murray came over to Capitol Tower, they'd get the word would, you know, get through the Capitol building. To 13th floor was, you know, the president, and Al was on the 11th or 12th floor. And the word would get out, Murray Wilson's here, and Al would hide under his desk because he knew Murray was going to ask him what's going on with the record. Why isn't it in the charts? Why isn't it going higher? Why don't we have a bullet this week, you know? And so I got to know Al, and he's a great guy. He's passed away. His son, Al Corey Jr., is, every once in a while I send him a post to tell him I miss his dad. His dad was one of my heroes. And so when I left, a friend of mine who's gone too, Larry Douglas, great record man, worked at RCA, hired me to leave Capitol and go to work for RCA. And I turned him down twice, and he kept giving me more money, right? Mm-hmm. You know, $50, $100 a week more. I was probably making, this is 1972, maybe 73. Mm-hmm. I was probably getting $300 a week at Capitol, you know, good. Mm-hmm. And I got reimbursed for mileage, you know, my car. And so he offers me $350 and I said no. And he offers me $400 and I said no. Mm-hmm. And he said, okay, I'm going to give you a company car. I said, company car? Yeah, I'll give you a new Ford Crown Victoria.
Yeah.
I said, you got me. I'm going to RCA. I'm going to Nipper, right? So I go there, and I doubt if it was maybe within 2 months, maybe 3 months. But I mean, I'm working John Denver, and I'm working Elvis, and I'm working the Hughes Corporation, I'm working B.W. Stevenson, and my Maria. I'm working some great records, but I get a call from my boss, Bob Spindler, who is my immediate boss. And he said, Fred, he said, I'm I'm going to come over and see you. You know, what are you doing this week? And I said, well, I've got to go to Virginia. I've got to go to Charleston, South Carolina. I've got to go to Augusta, Georgia. I've got to go to Knoxville, Tennessee. You know, it's going to be a busy week. I got to go to Charlotte, to Big Ways. And he said, well, I need to come over and see you. And I said, Bob, I said, it's Monday morning. I said, I've been here a year. You've never been over to see me. I said, the only reason you could possibly want to come over to see me was to get the car and fire me. Mm-hmm. And he goes, I said, come on, Bob, fess up. You know, that's what you want to do, right? And he said, yeah. And he said, you know, Larry's gone and he got this new guy, Frank Mancini, and he wants to have his own team and he wants them to be loyal to him. And I said, okay, I'll tell you what, I'll leave the keys at Waze Radio, the radio station, and I'm out of here. I'm gone. Mm-hmm. So I hop in the car about a month later, I hop in the car and I go out to see my folks. First break I'd had in a couple of years.
Yeah.
So I'm driving out. And I remembered I'd gotten to know Waylon Jennings really well. And Johnny Russell and Charlie Pride and Dolly and Porter. And back then we did what we call full line. We did everything that the label put out. There was no specialization like there is now. So Waylon had told me, he said, if you ever get burnt out at RCA, he said, I'm burnt out. I can't stand it. They don't want me to do this new outlaw music. They want me to do formula. I'm not a formula guy. Right. He said, you're going to get tired of them at some point and you're going to leave. And before you take a new job, come see me. So I'm driving out to California, my friend Leon Ward, and we stop at Graceland. And I paid my respects to Elvis is alive. You know, we got there in the middle of the night, like 1 a.m. and we went to the guard station. And Elvis was a huge Hank Snow fan, huge. Now, I had Hank's new album, Hello Love. I gave it to the guard and I said, you know, give this to Elvis. He's a huge Hank Snow fan. I know he'll appreciate it. And the guard said, well, what's your name? And I said, I'm Fred Vail. I just left RCA. I'm going out to California. He said, well, it's midnight. He said, just come on in and go up and walk around the circle driveway and take a look at Graceland. And so I go up, Leon and I go up in the middle of the night, go to Graceland, you know, and come back down, get in the car, go to California. Stopped in Nashville. And I met Waylon. He had just started a publishing company with Tom Paul Glazer and the Glazer brothers, Glazer Music. They had a studio on 18th. They had an office building. And I go in to see Waylon. And Waylon says, man, I can't give you what RCA gave you. Meaning I can't give you a company car and 400 a week. Right. But he said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you 100.5 a week and I'll give you a office and a telephone and you can take on other artists to promote. And Johnny Russell gave me a loan so I could get an apartment. And I went to work for Waylon and Tom Paul Glazer. And that was 74, spring of 74. And within about 2-3 months, I was doing independent promotion. I was working for GRT. We had this group called Alabama on the label. Earl Thomas Conley was on the label.
Yeah.
We had, I worked Captain's Daniil. Worked the Captain's Daniil first record. I worked, I called Al Corey. He had left Capitol and he was now at RSO, Robert Stigwood. And he had this little group called the Bee Gees. And he had this single kid that played great guitar named Eric Clapton. And I call Al and I said, Al, I said, you know that new Clapton record? And Lay Down Sally? He said, yeah. He said, we're getting it started. It's going up the pop charts. And I said, I think I can cross it over the country. He said, no way can you get Eric Clapton on country radio. No way. And I said, I can. Give me a chance. You know, send me 100 copies and I'll get it on country radio. And sure enough, about 4 weeks later, Eric Clapton's on country radio going up the country chart. Now, it didn't make it to top five, like pop. I think I made it to 26, 28, something like that.
Wow.
So Al sends me a gold record for Eric Clapton. So then now I'm working Clapton, Captain and Tennille, who was GRT, who's the artist? He's in the Hall of Fame, Dean. Jimmy Dean, IOU, Gold. What's the other country artist that did the Elvis tribute song after Elvis died? We got a record out in 2 days. It's almost impossible to do now. It's called The King Is Gone, Roddy McDowell. And it was Gold. Got it on. And I was trying to remember who else I worked. George Clinton, Parliament Funkadelic. I broke a record called Flashlight. Instead of him sending me a gold disc, he sends me a gold flashlight mounted on a plaque.
No way.
For breaking the flashlight.
That's an awesome track.
Parliament Funkadelic.
Yeah.
So, I mean, everything started to come together. But by this time, I'd been here for 6 years. I was 80. I'm really getting burnt out on promotion, calling radio stations 5 days a week, 8 hours, 9 hours a day. And some of the records I believed in, and some I didn't. And I found out how politics enters into it.
Yeah.
And so my friend Dave Shipley, who just died a year ago, February 14th, died on Valentine's last year. He and I found this studio that was going under called Ritchie House. It was owned by two brothers, the Ritchie brothers. Paul was a publisher, manager, and George was a songwriter, producer. And George had this wife, the first lady of country music. Her name was Tammy Wynette. Uh-huh. And they had the studio, and they were losing the lease, and they were losing their equipment to the bank. And we negotiated a deal to buy them out for $35,000. And out of that came Treasure Isle. 42 years later, you know, we're still there. I subleased the studio a few years ago. So I go there to do independent production. And occasionally, you know, I meet clients down there and meet friends down there and occasionally give tours of it to people. Yeah. But that, you know, so that I've been away from it physically. I've been away from it for about 5 years, give or take 5 years.
Well, we were just
still
down
there. I own it, but it's, I don't own the building. I own Treasure Island and own all the equipment.
Right.
So we've done everybody from Al Dean, 10 albums, Isaac Hayes, B.B. King, Dolly Parton, Charlie Pride, Sting recorded there. Waylon did his last album there. Michael W. Smith, Sandy Patty, Jars of Clay, Keith Urban, Alison Krauss. You know, the list goes on and on.
Wow.
But anyway,
it's a pretty special place. And Fred, you are a pretty special person. I got to tell you that. And
yes.
And it is such an honor to get to speak with you when we do. When you call me, I still. You talk about getting butterflies in RCAB. I get butterflies when I see your number come up on my phone, because I'm like an absolute legend. Stud is about.
Well,
to, I'm about to
you
talk
know,
to
I
him,
mean,
so.
But I just, I've been blessed. I truly have. I mean, this guy Frank, I told him, you know, it just started with my passion for music. I don't know if I mentioned it to you, but when I was born with this connective tissue called Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And it has to do with my skin. Uh-huh. And I started falling and I'd scrape my chin and they'd have to sew it up, go by a rose bush and a thorn would tear my leg open. I'd have to get it sewn up. And this happened continually up until the time of maybe around 12, 14, somewhere in that range. And finally, nobody had ever done anything. Nobody told me anything about it. And I go to this doctor, his name was Orrin Cook, and he was a general practitioner, and he'd sew me up. And back in those days, the dad was the breadwinner and the mom was the stay-at-home mom, you know, that led the Cub Scouts and the den mother and all that sort of stuff. And he said, well, Mrs. Vail, he said, there's something wrong with Freddie. He shouldn't be having all these accidents. He said, I'm going to take a snippet of skin and I'm going to send it off for a biopsy. So 3 weeks later, it's time to go get the stitches taken out. And he said, oh, I got the report back from, I think, the Mayo Clinic or somewhere.
Yeah.
And he said, Fred has this thing called Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. It's like a heredity thing. It's one in a million. And she said, well, what's the cure? And he said, there is no cure. You're born with it. He said, did you have it in your family? Not that I know. Did your husband have it in his family? Not that I know. And it's just a fluke. And, you know, he'll have to live with it. There's no cure. So my mom asked him, well, what advice do you have?
Yeah.
And I'll never forget this, because it changed my life. In retrospect, changed my life. He said, well, Fred's going to have to be careful. Just those two words, you'll have to be careful. So basically, Matt and Greg, when I'm 12, 13 years old, I know that being the Mickey Mantle on the Little League team is out. That ain't going to happen. Mm-hmm. Being the center on the basketball team ain't going to happen. Being the quarterback or wide receiver on the high school football team ain't going to happen. Mm-hmm. That ain't going to happen. And all the girls are motivated to these jocks, you know, these guys that are sports guys.
Yeah.
And I said, so what can I do to kind of carve a little niche for myself? And that's when Dave Leaf said that the teenager with the DJ voice comes into play.
Yeah.
So I start working at radio. And a Gopher, you did it for free. You go for this, you go for that. So during, you know, records, you'd bring coffee to the DJ or get him a pack of cigarettes or a Coke, and you'd cue records on the turntables. And you would do all that, you know, go into the newsroom and pull off the weather off the UPI, the United Press International or the Associated Press teletype machine that's clicking away. You do that. Mm-hmm. And then you take dedications over the phone, you know, and so I do that, you know, KCRA, KRAK, KROY, KXOA, then the job at KXRQ, the jazz station, working weekends for $1.52 an hour. And then the DJ PD summer of 1961, doing country music midday at KXOA FM radio, KCMW. And then that's when the concert thing kicks in. You know, I booked the high school, booked the, you know, the Miracles and Johnny Crawford and Bobby Freeman and Jan and Dean and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. And the Beach Boys in May of 1963. And then that changes my life. And then it sets me on a new course. But, you know, again, I mean, I often wonder, was getting this rare connective tissue condition, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, was that divine intervention?
Yeah.
Was that sending me a signal, Fred? You know, we're going to put your life on a different path.
Yeah.
And it's going to be based on your love of music and your love of people and being able to, you know, connect with people. And that's how it all starts. I mean, and still doing it, you know, and there's a really cool site on Facebook. It's this guy, Frank, who sent me a note. Uh-huh. He may be listening, but it's a page like yours, but it salutes the 50s and the 60s.
Mm. Cool. Yeah.
And it's really cool. And I know there's some members, maybe people that are listening to your show tonight that are members of that Facebook page. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they know what I mean, but every once in a while, they'll throw out a little thing like, okay, today we're going to talk about words that we used back in the 50s that you don't hear anymore. Or what was your favorite record? You know, and that's when, Good Night, My Love. I answered with Good Night, My Love and Surfer Girl for a slow dance at the senior prom or whatever. It's a great site. And I'm sure that people that belong to your page and to other Beach Boy tribute sites, I'm sure that they're aware of that site and they probably belong to it. And it's perfect for baby boomers because it's, you know, every once in a while somebody will talk about the 70s, but it's really more connected to the 50s and 60s. Sure. Than it is the 70s. Some girl just posted today about she loves the 50s and 60s, but she also loves the 70s. She's a Beach Boy fan. She's probably on their site. I can't remember her name, or I'd do a shout out. But she said, well, don't forget the 70s, because two of my favorite top 10 Beach Boy albums are 70s, Sunflower and Polyp. I said, yeah, you're right.
That's right. I said,
you know, I mean, Sunflower is in my top 10.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Holland's a great album, but, you know, it's not in my top 10, but it's a great album.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's this thing, this music thing just has a way of connecting people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, if it wasn't for music in general and the Beach Boys in particular, you guys and I wouldn't have connected.
Yeah,
that's, you know, that's true.
if I wouldn't have 5,000 Facebook friends 75% of them are probably Beach Boy related.
Right.
Most likely. I mean, some because of Treasure Island, the country music industry, and, you know, that sort of thing. But the majority of them are probably Beach Boy related. And there's what, at least 30 tribute sites now between different sites, your guys' site and the tribute sites for Denny and Carl and Bruce and Mike, and, you know, the Beach Boys and the history of the Beach Boys. And I don't know, it just goes on and on and on and on. But, you know, it kind of interconnects all of us. You know, we have that common bond. You know, I call you guys my diehards.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because, you know, you live and eat and sleep Beach Boys. With me, I ate, lived, and breathed music up until the Beach Boys.
Right.
And then Beach Boys. But, I mean, going back before then, I mean, you know, and basically when I was diagnosed with Ehlers-Danlos, it was 1954, right around 54. And the doo-wop groups and the, you know, rock and roll was in its infancy. And I was hooked on music.
Yeah.
I was hooked on all, you know, the Platters and Buck Ram, who wrote some of their biggest hits and was their producer. I got to meet him and, yeah, you know, spend time with him at his home. And, you know, I mean, I just, you know, those memories, the opportunities I had because of timing, you know, Ricky Nelson on the set of Ossie and Harriet, Jimmy Rogers at the Venetian Room at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco, and the California State Fair, and Everly Brothers interviewing them. And I mean, all these things are, and the Everly Brothers are both gone, you know, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. They're gone.
Yeah.
And they influenced the Beach Boys, and they influenced Simon and Garfunkel. And I mean, they influenced virtually every harmony group that came. It's amazing that it was, the timing was perfect, you know. You know, and when I did a thing for let's see, where did we go? Just lost you guys.
We see you.
I see you and hear you still.
Yeah, well, if something popped up, ditch the 40-minute limit. How do I get rid of this stupid thing? Oh, where is it? Can't see it. It doesn't say. Well, as long as you can see me, you can hear me.
We can still see you, yeah.
Okay, well, I can't see you, but, you know, we were talking about the timing of it is incredible. It's phenomenal. And, you know, one thing led to another. And, you know, and here I am, 77 going on 78 in a month. And a 1 month from Thursday, this Thursday, 1 month from this Thursday, I turned 78. And my thing in radio and records goes back to basically 57. Yeah, about 56, 57. But then my music thing started, you know, kind of in a way, started when I found out I couldn't play sports and I couldn't be like the other guys. And I had to find an alternative, and it was music. And, you know, that absorbed my life. I mean, it just changed. It changed everything, you know, and then of course, the Beach Boys, May 24th, 63, that was, you know, that was the big bang. The Bristol Sessions in Bristol, Tennessee in 1925, when they came and recorded, they did 72 sides or tracks in 5 days. And out of those Bristol Sessions, Jimmy Rogers, the father of country music, the Carter family, mother Maybelle and AP and Sarah, Pop Stoneman and the Stoneman family. I mean, that three members of the Country Music Hall of Fame came out of those recording sessions in 1925. Johnny Cash called those sessions the Big Bang of country music. That's what he called it, the Big Bang of country music. So, you know, May 24th, 1963 was the Big Bang of Fred Vail.
Right.
That's when I met the Beach Boys.
That's right.
And it changed my life. I mean, no question about it.
Money,
I mean, had I booked the Challengers or the Merced Blue Notes or the Astronauts or the Safaris, all great groups, hit records, a few. Dick Dale, I booked him. Booked the Safaris. But had I chosen them for that gala concert at the Memorial Auditorium, my life would be completely different. You know, and instead I picked this surfing band up from Hawthorne, California. They're still living with their folks on West 139th Street. And yes, everything else goes from there. You know, that's my big bang, is the Beach Boys.
The legend.
So awesome.
Red Vail.
I don't know how I lost you. All of a sudden, you're not there and they're trying to pitch me.
That's okay.
Well, we see you. Well, Fred, you can't thank you enough for joining us tonight. What an honor, what a privilege to get to speak with you. And man, we love you so much. And that DVD is on its way. We'll make sure that you should have that the next couple of days.
One, you know, I got a Facebook post from a gal about an hour before I went on, and she said, I'm not going to be able to hear you live, but I'm going to go to their site and hear you tomorrow.
Yeah.
Yes.
I cannot remember her name, but I know she's out there because she told me that she was making an appointment to listen. I guess you archive these shows for a week.
Oh, yeah.
So Fred, you can say hi, YouTube, and they'll see, you know, it'll be on YouTube here in just a little bit. So you can, so hi to all the future people that are going to watch this. So,
oh, that's great. Yeah. Hi to Frank, who's on this 5060s site. I told him he should tune in because if he likes 5060s music, he's going to love your show.
Yeah.
There's no question.
Well, we love you, Fred.
Such an honor, Fred.
Thank you very much. Hey, please give.
And my dogs didn't bark. They cooperated.
Yeah.
They were silent.
Yeah.
It's amazing. God is looking after me again.
Hey, will you please thank your beautiful wife for us again for letting us steal you.
She's about 15 feet from me and she heard you. So
good.
Thank you.
We're grateful for her too. Awesome.
Well, so am I. I'm grateful. Her knee is. She had total knee replacement on the 25th of January.
Oh, that's right.
Mm.
She's recuperating, and she's walking without a walker or a cane, not full-time, but around the house. And we actually made it to see two movies in the past week, and she made it from the car to the theater without her walker or cane. And both had music in them. You guys need to see it. Belfast, if you haven't seen it,
it's
got some great music. And that's what the Van Morrison, I think, is pretty much featured in that one. And what was another one? There's another movie we just saw. What was that? Oh, Dog. Dog is full of country music.
Dog.
It was The Gambler is in it. Chris Stapleton closes the show, you know, does the music over the credits at the end. And there's a whole bunch of country stuff in Dog. Cute movie. I don't know if it'll be a sequel, but it's a cute movie. I mean, it's worth going to see. You know, Belfast was interesting. It's basically black and white for 99% of the movie. It starts out in color, then it shifts to, you know, black and white to give it that, you know, 50s feel.
Oh, that's cool.
It's some good, you know, Morrison music is in it. There's some good music in it.
Yeah.
They close, it's interesting. My studio is on Azalea Place. I'm at 2808. Next door at 2806 is Blackbird Studios, John and Martina McBride. And then next to them at 2804 Azalea is a guy named Buzz Kaysen. And when Buzz started out as a teenager, he was in a group called the Casuals, and they were Brenda Lee's group. So he was on the road with Brenda Lee and got to meet Bobby Darin, who I regret never meeting, and Elvis and all that. But he and a guy named Matt Gayden, guitar player, wrote a song called Everlasting Love. And it's been a hit by Robert Knight in the 50s and 60s. It's been a hit by Carl Carlton in the R&B version in the 70s. It's been a hit by Gloria Estefan in the 80s. And it was a hit by Bono and U2 in the 90s. And believe it or not, Everlasting Love closes out the movie Belfast.
Really?
There's a live... live segment, they're playing in a nightclub, and this guy's on stage singing Everlasting Love.
That's cool.
And so, you know, that's what they call an evergreen in this business.
Yeah.
It just produces income forever and ever and ever. And he was lucky. Buzz is a great guy. And he did his book a few years ago. And he loves telling war stories like I do. And he wrote a song called Soldier of Love. And it's actually been in the Beatles anthology album. And I think Donny Osmond did a cut of it. So, I mean, Buzz is doing all right between Everlasting Love and Soldier of Love.
Yeah.
I don't think he has to worry about paying any bills forever and ever.
Fred, quick question. Do you remember when the Beach Boys played with Ray Stevens in 63?
You mean Ray Peterson?
Oh, maybe Ray Peterson.
Stevens. Australia. Forgot to tell you that. So I'm doing these shows with Ray in 63, 64, and I'm booking them in nightclubs and I'm booking them in the concerts. And I get a call from Murray and they're getting ready to do a tour. And Murray asks me, we need an opening act. Do you have any ideas? And I said, yeah, Ray Peterson. And they said, okay, can you find him for us? And I did. And he ended up going on the road. I know he did Australia. I think he did Hawaii. I'm not positive because I wasn't at either of those shows, but I think he did both those shows and maybe a few more. So that was the Beach Boy connection with Ray Peterson and how that all came about, because he had done such a great job for me. And the kids loved him. I mean, he was, you know, his range. I mean, you know, perfect pitch, 4.5 octaves. I mean, you know, like I said, he'd give Frankie Valli a run for the money anytime.
Fred,
a great guy.
I'm gonna have to look that up and see.
Yeah, Fred, I'm not sure about that, Fred. We might argue about that one.
What about Frankie Valli and
about
Ray Peterson,
Ray Peterson being anywhere close to Frankie Valli? But
we'll have to check it out.
You listen. He the first record. How I heard him, and it wasn't a hit, but he did it. It was, I think it was his first record on RCA, 1958, and he did a little Willie John, Fever.
Oh yeah.
You know, it became a classic by Peggy Lee. It was her signature song for her entire life, but it was a little Willie John song. And Otis Blackwell wrote it, and Fever. And I heard that on the radio in Sacramento, probably on KXOA or Crack. And I heard this voice coming out of the radio, and I thought, good golly, who is that? And I ended up going down to a record store. This is before Tower. This was, you know, like I said, this is probably 58.
Yeah.
And I bought the single, and it was in a picture sleeve. They would put out these records in, you know, they did a lot with Elvis, Baby, and Frankie Avalon. They did these picture sleeves on these 45s. And so I get this record, Fever, by Ray Peterson. And I just had to listen to it over and over and over again, because the voice was something that I'd never heard anything like that before. You know, and he predated Frankie Valli, obviously.
Right.
So, you know, I just ended up, always wanted to see him, always wanted to meet him, because The Wonder of You, which was top 20, and Tell Laura I Love Her, which I think went to number 7, and then Karina, you know, it went top 20, if I recall. Goodnight, My Love only made it, his version of Goodnight, My Love, I think made it to 70. Jesse Belvin went to, I think Jesse Belvin's version in 56 went to number 3, I believe. But, you know, I finally ended up working with him in 1963, you know, and then we become lifelong friends. Yeah. And I always regretted I wanted to do a jazz album on him, because he would have made a great jazz album.
I can see that.
And I didn't have any way to fund it. I mean, I had the studio,
right?
And, you know, that's just one portion. I mean, you know, the engineer, the musicians, the arrangers, you know, tuning the piano, cartage for the drums. I mean, all that costs money. And I didn't have an overwhelming bank account at that time. And, you know, if I had, I would have taken Ray in and recorded a jazz album, because, you know, I could have, you know, given him the studio time. That wouldn't have been a problem. But it was all the other incidental expenses that I couldn't cover. But that would have been great to have one, you know, now in retrospect, to have a jazz album by Ray.
Yeah.
But, you know, he was just, I mean, the thing about Ray that made him so special is that he was such a great guy. Everybody, including the Beach Boys, loved Ray Peterson.
Yeah.
He was just incredible, you know, and it's funny. when I started doing his shows, and it's like I said, if you go to Ray Peterson's Wikipedia, it'll mention Fred Vail, who gave him, they give me credit for his comeback in the 60s. And they'd re-release The Wonder of You based on all the shows that I was booking.
Right.
And Elvis called him up. Ray told me this story. Elvis called him up and he said, Ray, he said, this is Elvis. And they'd been on RCA together back in the 50s. And he said, I just wanted you to know that I'm going to record The Wonder of You. And is that cool? And Ray says, of course, you're Elvis. And you know what Elvis said? He said, yeah, I'm Elvis, but you're Ray Peterson.
Yeah, that's cool.
Awesome.
Pretty cool story, huh?
Yeah, that's an amazing story.
Getting misty-eyed again, like meeting Jay Cook telling me the Beach Boys aren't hip anymore.
Fred,
you guys are my therapist. Are you just
hey. Me a bill? Fred, we'll be here for you anytime you need us, man. Your stories are fantastic, and I could listen to you forever, man. You are awesome.
Same.
We love you so much and so grateful for you.
Well, I'm grateful to you guys and keeping the legends, the real legends, the Beach Boys alive.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And all the tribute sites and all the wonderful people that are listening to this show that keep the legend of the Beach Boys and Brian and DW and Carl alive. You know, you guys, in a way, you guys are my heroes because you're keeping it alive. And thank God for this generation who's introducing it to the next generation. You know, I think I may have told you guys, I went to a show to see Kentucky, Huntington. It was in Huntington, West Virginia, or near the Kentucky border. I think it was Huntington, West Virginia. And I went to see, Al was there, and I can't remember the setup. This was 10 or 15 years ago, at least, you know, and I always, you know, I love hanging out backstage. It's cool. But I always love going out into the audience and seeing the audience reaction. And it was downtown, and it was a free show, and it was sponsored by the Downtown Merchants Association. Mm-hmm. And it was right along the river. I guess it was the Ohio that would go through there. And so I'm in the back, you know, 2/3 of the way back in the audience, which is packed, and it's right downtown. And I'm standing there, and all of a sudden I realize that there's these three men in front of me. And it was the grandfather, the son, and the grandson. And they're all singing to the Beach Boy music. Three generations right in front of me.
Awesome.
And I said, that's what it's all about.
That's right. That's right.
Amen.
All right.
How many times that's happened? I mean, it's happened more than once.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, I don't know that'll ever stop. You know, good music seems to find its way to people that are open to hear, to listen.
There are people, there are grandfathers and grandsons introducing grandkids to the Beach Boys. Probably at every concert that Brian and Al and Blondie give, and every concert that Mike and Bruce give.
Yeah.
And there's probably three generations out there, you know, maybe even four generations by now that are still singing along with fun. And California Girls and Be True to Your School. And, you know, God Only Knows and all that. I mean, and now they're doing songs thanks to Phil Flows. They're doing songs, you know, like Add Some Music and
that's right.
Songs like that, Wendy, and, you know, some of the other great songs that weren't a part of the Beach Boys show when Carl and DW were alive.
Right.
You know, they were added since then. I think I first heard Add Some Music when Al was out with family and friends, and Wendy and Carney were on that show. Mm-hmm. And Billy was on that show, God bless him. And Ed Carter was on that show. Uh-huh. And trying to remember Who else? There were a couple other people too.
Probably Matt, right? Matt Jardine, I think.
Yeah, Matt was, and I think Richard Beera was.
Yeah.
I think he was on it. I mean, and they were doing Adson music, and that was probably 20 years ago, maybe, I'm thinking. I saw him in Atlanta. I only saw it once. I saw him at Outdoor Amphitheater in Atlanta at Stone Mountain. And it was great just hearing that. You know, I always loved Adson music. I it should have been a hit. And it's timeless. I mean, I wish it, somebody else would record it now, you know, that had a name and a label who believed in them. You know, I told you guys about Warner's. The problem with Warner's was it was a great label, you know, and it gave the boys a certain amount of credibility because, you know, James Taylor was on the label and he was hot. And, you know, Sinatra owned you know, the sister label of Reprise. And, you know, it was a cool place to be, but they never should have left Capitol because Capitol had the Beach Boy catalog.
Right.
And, you know, when they went to Warner's, Warner had no catalog. They had nothing at stake.
Right.
You know, they didn't have an investment in the Beach Boys other than that record contract, you know. And of course, when Capitol, you know, is still making money off Beach Boys.
Yeah.
And it's been 50 years.
60. Yeah, that's right. Years,
yeah.
Right 60, now. Yeah.
Crazy. And then Capitol's still making money.
Yeah.
And Herb Alpert and A&M Publishing still making money. Of course, Brian and Mike are making money. Everybody's, you know, the state of Dennis and Carl Wilson are, you know, making money. Dennis, unfortunately, not as much as Carl's estate.
Right.
But that's another story at another time.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's going to keep going.
Well, speaking of another time,
you guys are 40 years plus old, younger than I am. It's going to outlive you.
Yep. Hey, if we have anything to do with it, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Fred, we love you.
Okay. Love you guys too.
Thank you
love
so
your
much.
Audience.
Hey.
Love your audience. Love hearing from them on the various sites. And, you know, have them post on my Fred Vail page or the Friends of Fred Vail that Taylor Rudkin set up after I reached my 5,000 limit. He set up his Friends of Fred Vail page, and, you know, so go there. Let me
Everybody,
know you heard it.
Go sign up, Fred Vail. We'll put a link on our page as well so people can sign up there, Fred.
Send a post. You know, they can say their name, where they live, and where they saw their first Beach Boy concert in what year.
I love it.
Awesome. Perfect.
And a few of them, if they want to get brownie points, they can say their favorite album, Beach Boy Concert, 1964.
There you go.
That's not required. That's just a bonus.
Okay.
All right, guys.
Fred.
Have a good one. Love you.
Thank you, Fred.
You take care.
Always a pleasure.
Take care.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
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 Why does it do that? Anyway.
He's so great.
Man. He's awesome. I love Fred. Everybody, thank you for joining us tonight. Thanks for all of you, you know, folks on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitch. We really appreciate you you joining us and hanging out with Fred. He's just got so many stories, Matt. And yeah, I'm thinking why he's talking is I love listening to Fred because you're going to hear stories you've heard before, and they're always exciting to it's like you're there.
Yeah.
But there's always a chance that you're going to get something new that you haven't heard before, right? There's like a little tidbit where you're like, I haven't heard this before, and this is really cool. And I'm just real thankful for Fred for coming on.
So many little tidbits of interesting information. And I love the Four Seasons story, the Carl and Dennis. That was really cool. I mean, they took him out on his birthday, you know.
Yeah, Carl
took
and
him
Dennis
up on his birthday
up.
To see the Four Seasons. What a story. Yeah. So what a guy. So I really appreciate that. And thanks everybody for joining us
tonight.
Yeah,
thanks a lot. It means a lot. Your support every week is huge. It is awesome. And like Fred said, it's about keeping the music alive and fighting the good fight because there's, you know, unfortunately there's just not a lot of great music out there, at least popular music anyway. It seems to get worse and worse. So we gotta keep letting folks know. But next week, speaking of great music, we're gonna welcome on our very good friend Evan Hawley, who's gonna help us break down the 2020 album, which is gonna be really fun. So we're gonna talk through the 20. So get your 2020 album all revved up for next week. We're gonna have fun, but we love you. Thanks again for joining us, everybody. It was a good time.
Yeah, thank you, everybody. And thanks, brother.
Y'all have a good night. Love you, Matt.
Love you too.
Good night, y'all.